to Zion. I'm Elder Ricascio of the Gathering of Christ Church here. Elder Lawyer. Yes, Elder Lawyer is back in our presence. Thank the Most High for bringing him back safe and sound here for our Sabbath lesson. All right? That's right. I called Elder Lawyer this morning. I said, Elder Lawyer, I know you've been traveling, this, that, and the other. I know you're going through a lot. I called up Yurok, Elder Yurok, and said, why don't you just read in place of Elder Lawyer? And I guess Elder Lawyer thought about it. The Sabbath, he'd been away for a while. He's like, he called me, he says, listen, if you can start up around 12:30, I'm there. You know, okay, let's get it.
Yes, sir.
Let's get it. Y'all see the title? You all see the title. This is going to be a different type of lesson, so make sure you like, you share, and tell everyone you know about the lesson today. Okay? Tell everyone you know about this lesson, believers or unbelievers, it doesn't matter. This lesson will resonate and eventually bring the unbelievers on, that's right, on team righteousness. Thank you. Please hit the like button. And yes, 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 tomorrow we'll be going into who is the synagogue of Satan? Identifying the synagogue of Satan. That's right. Those people that Christ warned us about also. I know the blasphemy of them which say they are and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. Well, we're going to do that and we're going to tie that into the Jesuits who came in with a false narrative concerning Christ's coming. We hate to be the bearers of bad news, Christians. There will be no rapture. The synagogue of Satan purposely infiltrated Christianity to distort the narrative of Christ's coming. One of many deceptions the deceivers have done. What better way to get Satan's arch enemies, those who can oppose him on the sideline, than to make them believe that they don't have to engage being that when the tribulation comes, they're already someplace else. What better way to put Satan's top enemies on the sideline? What better way? The only people who can control, who can actually, folks, the only people who can oppose this system are those who believe in Christ and they know it. So the Jesuits came together and said, you know what? Let's initiate Christians into our religion, paganism, and let's teach them an ideology that would put them on the sideline in the end days. Let's tell them that they'll be raptured, therefore they won't care about the future and what the Antichrist system has in store for everyone. See? That and more tomorrow. Identifying the synagogue of Satan, and guess what? To some degree, through Christ's words, we'll start off that lesson right now, segueing into tomorrow. That's right. Exposing the synagogue of Satan will be our lesson tomorrow. You don't want to miss it. And while we're talking on the Academy, I'm not going to make no announcements here for the Academy until the lesson is done. This is what I'm going to need you all to do, brothers and sisters. Okay? In about a month, we will start a brand new Hebrew and Bible Academy. Okay? The haters, even the theologians, they hate the fact that we're breaking these things out, revealing the truth, on top of revealing the truth, right? Bringing many of our people to the knowledge of our book. They hate it. This is why they hate the Hebrew and Bible Academy. Why? Because usually theologian groups get all of these grants, finances, and all that on top of charging Christians to come through and learn the false ideology, which is modern day Christianity. Okay? It's a con game, the theologian schools, and we're only doing it for a low, low price and giving you the true information concerning the Bible, and they hate it. In a month's time, this is what I would like. They're trying to attack, come against the Hebrew and Bible Academy and all that, folks. And I understand why, because it's affecting their bottom line, number one, and we don't even charge that much. See? We charge enough to do what? To be able to operate and to expand the knowledge to more people. And they hate it. So what I want to do in this next Hebrew and Bible Academy, folks, even though you brothers and sisters understand the experience, Hebrew, news, that you cannot speak on any social media out here without getting banned or censored. On top of that, lessons, giving you the true narrative of the Bible, and I'm going to show an example of that today of how we work this thing in the academy. What I would like for the next academy, I would like to break records concerning how many in number who have ever entered the Hebrew and Bible Academy. That's the challenge out there. If this church have blessed you and helped you understand this, even if you've been in it before or if you've never been a part of it, let's show the enemy that they cannot come against the Most High servants and work. And show your appreciation for everything we're doing, bringing forth this truth. Go to historytimes.org and be a part of it. And what we're going to do to the enemy is show them that they can't stop this. Check out these numbers. You're trying to come against it. You're trying to attack it. But our people, God's people, are behind us. They appreciate the work we put in. That's right. When the cameras are off, we're putting in work. And the brothers and sisters are going to show this in number. Go to historytimes.org. And I would like to see us, brothers and sisters, break all the numbers that we've ever done in the past concerning numbers in this Hebrew and Bible Academy. And guess what? Those in the future academies will not be disappointed with the information. And I'm going to show you, I'm going to give you a little insight to how we do this. HistoryTimes.org. Make the enemy cringe. All right. Make the enemy cringe. You got the enemy, all that, you're sending emails and all. Yeah, how many people y'all got in the academy? Does that? Let me make it clear to you. When you had our people in numbers going through your theologian schools, no one was counting heads to how many of our pastors, preachers, or the high intellects of academia within our communities, left our community, following your false ideologies through your theologian schools. But when we, whom the Most High have, did what? He raised us from the dirt to heal and help our people. You're concerned with how many people are learning under us when the whole world has been deceived by you? You need to check out how they do this, brothers and sisters. No one is going to Creflo Dollar, T.D. Jakes. No one is going to Kenneth Copeland, a top Jesuit, and asking him how many is in his theologian classes, how many is in his Bible schools. No, you dare question the master.
They perfected this practice in shooting chips in you.
Destroying our people. The more Christianity we get, the more deceived and destroyed we become. And guess what? The Most High has something in this earth that's going to bring you the knowledge. Do the research for you. Give you the resources to let you know. And not only that, give you the resources that you can get yourself to stand on the word. And the enemy hates this. They give it out to you in drips and drugs so you can be a part of their satanic cabal and and try to get information from them hands and feet like a dog instead of telling you you're the children of Israel. Folks, let's show them, folks. Let's show them. Go to historytimes.org and let's show them. And I'm gonna show them that the more they come against it, the more the grassroots in this earth, God's people will support us. Now let's jump in. Good to have you back.
Yes, sir. Good to be back.
Woo! We're gonna get it in today, boy. I'm chopping at the bit for this lesson here. I'm chopping at the bit. Hit that like button. All right. Here we go. The insane world Christ warned us about. Now, before I go into Matthew 24, because I have to break it down, right? He warned us about this crazy world. And the reason most people are confused in this earth concerning these times and don't realize that we've always been controlled by Satanists, witches, warlocks, evildoers. You know why? Because they were able, brothers and sisters, to flip things upside down. And they were able to turn our people, God's people, into believing into. They targeted us. In order for them to turn things upside down concerning Christ is coming, they had to target us and destroy us through different religions, ideologies, and ideas led by the Roman Christian Church. Led by the Roman Christian Church, folks. So when we go into the insane world Christ warned us about, we have to understand some of the tactics of the devil and his ministry. Tactics like, okay, the Bible. One day the people of the Bible will oppose our order.
All right, pull my coat on this now. What happens if you give all that up? I mean, the pork and you get sick and then you get a medical or something?
Like when I was on the outside, I ran this hustle. I tried to act
I'm telling you God's words, not no hustle. And I'm gonna tell you, God is black.
God is black? Everybody knows God is white.
Everything the white man taught you, you accepted. He taught you you were a black heathen and you believed him. He taught you to worship a blonde, blue-eyed Jesus with white skin, and you believed him. He taught you that black was a curse, and you believed that. Did you ever look up the word black in a dictionary?
For what?
Did you ever study anything that wasn't part of some con?
What the hell for, man?
Come with me.
Black, destitute of light, devoid of color. Enveloped in darkness, hence utterly dismal or gloomy, as the future looked black.
Pretty good with them words, ain't you?
Soiled with dirt, foul, sullen, hostile, forbidding, as a black day. Foully or outrageously wicked, as black cruelty, indicating disgrace, dishonor, or culpability. And there's others. Black male, black bald, black guard.
Yeah, well, that's something all right.
Let's look up white. Here. Read.
White. Of the color of pure snow. Reflecting all the rays of the spectrum. The opposite of black. Free from spot or blemish. Innocent. Pure. Huh. Ain't this something? Without evil intent. Harmless. honest, square dealing, and honorable. Wait a minute, but this was written by white folks, though, right? I mean, this white folks' book?
This sure ain't no black man's book.
So what are we reading this one for?
Because the truth is lying there. If you read behind the words, you got to take everything the white man says and use it against him.
How do we politically and religiously get in front of this?
Miss Tan, are there any questions?
Hey, watch it, baby. This cat is heavy on religion.
I can see this has become a struggle between good and evil. Satan has a question.
Yes, sir, Chaplain Gill, but since neither one of us are God, I don't think either one of us are in any position to say who's good and who's evil.
Why don't you just ask your question?
We were discussing the disciples. What color were they?
Well, I don't think we know that for certain.
But they were Hebrews, were they not?
That's right.
As was Jesus. Jesus was also a Hebrew.
Why don't you just ask your question?
What color were the original Hebrews?
I have told you that we don't know that for certain.
Then you can't believe for certain that Jesus was white.
Just a moment. God is white. Isn't it obvious?
Well, that is obvious, but we don't know if it's obvious that God is white. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that Jesus did not have blonde hair and blue eyes. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that the images of Jesus that are on prison walls and churches throughout the world are not historically correct, because history teaches us that Jesus was born in a region where the people had color. There's proof in the very Bible that you ask us to read in Revelation 1st chapter, verse 14 and 15, that Jesus had hair like wool and feet the color of brass.
Just what are you saying?
I'm not saying anything. I'm proving to you that Jesus was not. And I might quote one of our Indian brothers. He was not a pale face.
Aha.
Amen.
Isn't that interesting?
Well, you know, their intellects, their so-called intellects. Suppose we shape the ideas that would have them hate their own book. Let's shape a society that would have them oppose the only book that can help them. Well, how do we do this, pray tell? It's easy. Eventually, they're going to realize we've been using and abusing them, and they'll hate us. Let's just make them believe that
you
the people in the
God,
Bible
you got
are us.
The law put it there.
That would totally confuse them.
These books are for white folks. They're full of things your kind wouldn't understand.
They would love us on one hand for being the people.
Study hard here.
But they would hate us on the other hand.
Your slaves sure do know how to behave.
Well, they got
for how we're treating.
One of them's a preacher.
People might pay good money to have them calm down a bit, especially by one of their own.
I lead you to Peter.
Well, how's we gonna pull this off?
Submit yourself.
These people know that they're the children of Israel.
Not only to those who are good and considerate, but also to those.
We can't do it today. It's gonna take time.
I have taken a life. I have created a son.
I have been in love.
I am the son of Pope Alexander VI. He who decides morals.
The seat of Holy Mother Church is empty.
I urge you, brothers, to preserve the sanctity of this institution.
I do not want to be Pope. I want to be a king, emperor.
Why do you pretend that I contribute to my own fate?
This lovemaking is erratic.
Who serves you best, O Lord?
I fear you're trying to extinguish a fire with fire.
Enough!
Test my c***.
Who the f*** is that?
We are the Rock of Christ, the Father of Kings. God speaks with our voice.
When we seek what is best for ourselves, we are seeking what is best for Him.
I will be Pope again.
In more than name.
I'm not tired.
Patience. my fellow men.
Amen.
What you mean? They all know they're Israel. Patience. We'll set up the universities and we'll control the religious access to God. Churches. We'll slowly but surely disconnect them from their God and do what? Well, of course, Israel, the mother of Israel, will always, that land would all, Zion would always cry and call for her children. One day they're going to seek out, you know, they're going to try to seek their original homeland. Yeah, that is an issue. Africa will tell them that their motherland is Africa. They'll never seek Zion. You know, if we do this and take these people completely from their law with no way back, these people are going to lose their minds. Without their God, they're nothing. They're going to go crazy. I mean, you're talking about whoremongering, witchcraft, evil. The earth will be overran with wickedness if these people, who are the people of God, began to sin in number. Exactly, that's the plan. Because once they become evildoers, separated from the law, thinking they're Africans, out there just sleeping with everyone else, out of their minds, dealing with witchcraft, sorcery, and all types of evil, we're not going to have to proclaim publicly that these are not the children of God. We're not going to have to proclaim that. In their actions, the whole world will know that these people couldn't possibly be the chosen. Just look at them, and then they'll see our children. And we'll have control over the media, over information, access to information, and everything they do wrong, we'll publicize it negatively. And surely, at the very end, the people will realize it must be us. So let's take you back now. It must be us. We must be the holy.
In effect, is to normal. Legitimize a lot of the views of these groups.
The turning of things upside down. A matter of fact, seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read. We're going to show you the insane world Christ warned us about. Where the insane would be what? Controlling the asylum. And the same people that was behind lying to our people, folks, guess what? They're behind all of the agendas you're seeing being pushed on the liberal left side. They're working either side. But only the Bible can point them out. Tell everyone in your family, I don't care who you are, they need to see this lesson today. If they have never seen a lesson from the gathering of Christ Church. Isaiah 34 and 16, read it.
Yes, sir. Isaiah 34, verse number 16. Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read.
Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read. That means the answers is in the book we're reading from. We have caught the devil red-handed, even though he've incentivized a certain segment of our people to hate this book. The Bible's tampered with. Give me some proof of that. How many interpretations of the Bible are there? Why is it the Bible is the only book you question when it comes to how many interpretations? Huh? When the Quran has 19 different scripts, 19 different interpretations of the Quran, why are everyone concerned about what's wrong with the Bible? Huh? How many books we've read and then they come with a new revision of the same book? And no one questioned whether or not that book has valid, is valid. Why is it that the Bible is the only book that that can be questioned? Y'all need to really think about that, folks. Because they knew that this would be the book that would tear their whole system down. Not just revealing who the children of Israel are, but who they are. So the best way to get them out of it, our people, is to say, well, listen, the white man enslaved us and gave us the book. Another lie that will be disproven today. Another lie. The white man didn't give us this book, folks. That's a bold-faced lie. What they don't want to tell you is that there were free black people who weren't in slavery during the time of slavery reading the book.
I see that pistol in your waist.
I got a reason.
The book that came from England.
I could just speak to Mr. Murray.
I'm a son. First, you need to prove to me you ain't.
It was these men before getting compromised who was giving the book to the likes of Nat Turner and others and saying, well, listen, there's no way to fight against these people. They're the devil. We must stand with God and read our forefathers' records. And they were secretly teaching slaves and all that and giving them the Bible and saying, here is the weapon to use against them. All black people in the 1700s and the 1600s were enslaved, folks. We had three men bringing the Bible over from England. So that's another lie. It's a white man's book.
Nice hot steam.
Another lie. I mean, we had high intellects, highly educated.
George.
Even Benjamin Banneker, a black man who designed what we call Washington, D.C. Of course, he was on the elitist side, but nonetheless, that was a black man. So we have to get out of this crazy notion that every black person in the 1600s and 1700s was under chattel slavery. But what we're telling you today and what's being revealed to you today, folks, this is what the elites feared.
This African is doing amazing things. He invented an electric car that can run without a battery and without recharging, a television set that works perfectly without power, and a helicopter that flies without fuel. Maxwell Chikumbutso, a Zimbabwean, has shown that his genius can weaken the economies of the superpowers to the benefit of Africa. He has three assassination attempts to his credit. He invented a technology to turn radio frequencies into electricity. He applied for a patent for his work but was repeatedly denied. The reason given is that he deviated from the laws of physics.
They feared our people coming back to the book without any Edomite or Roman intrusion. Okay. That's right. They feared that we would get the information separate from them. Then they'll try to have an Arab waddle in and try to come through. And nah, brother, you sit down too and listen. We know that you Ishmael is in bed with Esau. What you can do is listen. Like when I was on Peace FM, them so-called experts and all of them came through, and I told them the only thing they can do is sit there and listen. We've heard from them long enough, and look at the conditions of our people. You're liars. So what they'll do is they'll try to send in one of their little vermins from another nation to try to come in and co-sign or agree, only to bring their ideas to distort the information. And I wasn't having it. When they sent the rabbis, I wasn't having it, okay? Now, listen, what you're going to do is learn, sir. You had a long time to deliver what was right to our people, and our people's conditions are getting worse and worse. Read it, El Deloy.
Yes, sir. Isaiah 34, verse number 16.
Come on.
Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read.
Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read. The Bible is the answer, folks. And if it isn't the answer, those who oppose it must bring the answer. And if you don't have the answer when we ask, we're telling you the Bible is the answer. Period. That's a simple foundation we can all agree on. If you disagree with this being the book that gets us on code, you must bring a solution and a solution fast. Because at least we have a starting point. And if you don't have a solution other than, well, it can't come from the Bible, you have to shut up and get in line. You're part of the problem. You're part of the confusion. Because you can't shoot down a solution without one. So I'll be ready to say, I'll listen to those being in academia and others and who would claim, well, everyone don't believe in the Bible, so we have to find another way to come together. I'm open for that. How? Right now, what's the solution?
And I think that fake news have been with us for thousands of years. Just think of the Bible. But there is.
See, they don't expect us to respond back with that. Because if we don't have a foundation that points to the drag, the sin, the evil that's stopping us from progressing, then you don't have no idea who you're getting in bed with, who you're joining alliances with. And with the Bible, it allows us to understand the starting point of what people can be trusted to finish this and bring resolution. So it first starts with the book. Because with the book, we can now try the people and know who to trust and who not to trust going forward. See? Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read. Come on.
No one of these shall fail.
Not one Bible prophecy has failed yet. Not one. So some people might ask, well, why should we trust the book? Well, show me a prophecy in the Bible that failed. That's why we should trust it. Transhumanism, mark of the beast, the new system we see now, putting stuff in people, getting ready for a cashless society. It was all in the book. It was shown to John on the Isle of Patmos by Christ himself. So you show me another book you can get all this from. The knowledge of what, of history.
Yeah.
The knowledge of history, folks.
You know, I was just sitting back reflecting.
The knowledge of how our people were once great in Israel and were scattered through due to disobedience, and historical facts that the Romans would come against them, Esau, that was prophesied, and that we would serve slavery in a foreign land. And then eventually, they would set up an economic system to keep us trapped. It's through their economic system is what keeps the Gentiles above us. And when we learn the game, they change the game every time. Okay, they learn how to do this. They learn how to do that. Okay, let's change the economic system again. What's your credit score? And we're looking around like, credit score? We were used to cash and carry up in the hood. What is this? They found a new way to keep us out. And then when we got to the credit score and learned to get our credit score together, well, okay, we have to see if you got any felonies or what, that, and the other. And we learned how to keep clean and not be illegal and be upstanding citizens. And then they'd be like, well, okay, let's change the system now, okay. Listen to me clearly, brothers and sisters. This is what you missed when I was talking, when the sound came out real quick. This is what you were missing. The whole system was set up to keep That's right, an invisible ceiling against the children of God ever rising above our current status. That's all it was. Transhumanism, all that they're talking about, Revelation, the 13th chapter, Mark of the Beast. They must change the economic system as we become more aware of who they are. And the last stage in this is to make total control of all products so that they can control who rises and who stays on the bottom. Mark of the Beast, electronic system with no financial, that's right, no financial wealth outside of it being digital. What other book talks about this? Can you learn about our current time through the Quran? Hades to the no. Come on, let's go.
Yes, sir. Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read.
Come on.
No one of these shall fail.
No one of these shall fail. Not one prophecy of the Bible failed yet. So if someone asks you and try to claim the Bible's tampered with, you ask him, can you tell me a prophecy in the Bible that have failed? And another thing we have to stop doing, we got to stop giving the ignorant a voice. We have to stop thinking because you have an opinion, it's merited. Okay? See, one thing Esau has, he has amongst his people, he has classes of people, and he has what? Lines when it comes to professions. Where your opinion means nothing. Okay? Unless you are credentialed in a certain area, your opinion means nothing. And what we don't have amongst our people is that type of respect to where, okay, just because you're thinking and have an opinion, don't you know you can do far worse speaking and giving your opinion on something when it comes to what? When it comes to actually bringing things together when it matters.
Well, I don't know about that. I don't know about that. They coming out of the Bible.
What do you know about the Bible? What in life has given you any understanding to make an opinion negatively about it?
Well, you see what those preachers doing? You see,
you're ignorant. The Bible speaks of false preachers and how to identify them. That's not my fault. You didn't read it in the Bible to avoid them. Mm-hmm. That's not our fault. It's not the Bible's fault. The Bible points out false teachers. The Bible points off pastors who are pagans and really they are aligned with Satan, but yet you go in there to hear the word of God without trying them. Don't blame that on the Bible. You can't blame creative flow of dollars, T.D. Jakes, Kenneth Copeland, Joel Osteen. You cannot blame none of them on the Bible because the Bible warned us about them and how to avoid them. So don't come with that stuff. Many people had the Bible when you haven't read it yourself. You got to the only weapon that can destroy this whole empire. The only spiritual weapon that can bring this kingdom down is the Bible itself. Because again, it shows us starting out who to trust and who not to trust. Elder Lawyer.
Yes, sir.
The Bible also told us that they'll be turning things upside down. I'll finish reading what you got there.
Yes, sir. Picking up in Isaiah 34 and 16. None of these or no one of these shall fail. None shall want her mate.
And none shall want her mate. You cannot make the book with any other book. Come on.
For my mouth it hath commanded, and his spirit it hath gathered them.
And his spirit it hath gathered them. And I'm going to show you how great the Bible is. It gives us scenarios that the empire that would try to push that we can totally ignore. And I was talking to him about the Brittany Griner thing or something, which is a no story as far as we're concerned. We could care less about what happened to her over there, and we could care less about whether or not they're going to release her, because I understand what the Bible says. I could care less about these unrepentant evildoers who are out of order. Why should I care politically whether or not Russia got somebody who's out of order? That's a non-story. So what the Bible allows us to do is to focus on what's important. See? So now we cannot be politically used and abused by the sorcerers and the evildoers. And I'm using her as an example. Anything those people are dealing with, it's a non-story for us. Okay. Okay. You can easily put certain people, that's right, in the Antichrist closet. Okay. What you believe?
Well, the Bible tampered with, the white man did it.
Okay, Antichrist, you go over there. You stand in line with the rest of these evildoers. You can go over there.
Well, what about the Queen James Bible?
Okay, don't worry about it, brother. I'm opening the door for you. Go, there you go. Right up in the rest of them.
Hey, man, listen, man. I just got me a nickel bag. You know, I got this nickel bag, you know. I mean, I'm going to tell you, I got the skunk.
Don't worry about it. Let me open up the door. Antichrist door. There you go. Come on. It's getting tight up in there, but you go up in there. Mm. I'm going to tell you right now. A sister can walk down the street. She got a yellow wig on. Talking about, I'm a boss bee. Oh, don't worry about it. We got something for you, too. Hold up. Elder Lawyer, let's nudge this. Nudge them in. They're getting tight up in there. Mm. You get up in there right there, too. Hotep, my brother. Hotep. Okay, all right. Don't worry about it. A matter of fact, Hotep, we're going to make some room for you in your school. Go right, nudge you up in there and shut the door, lock it. And guess what? It has no floor. It goes directly into hell. All right? This is how we do it. The turning of things upside down. Let's do it.
Yes, sir. Isaiah 29, verse number 16.
Come on.
Surely your turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay.
Surely. Surely the turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay. Which means what? The Bible is exact with this. Right? The Bible tells us. Now, Christ is the word. The Bible tells us that turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay. Now, what is the message here? What is the Bible telling us this? Folks, I don't know if you grew up working with arts and crafts and having to make your little, you know, take the dirt and make your own clay to be able to shape a vase or a cup or make a plate or something like that. We grew up when you actually had to do arts and crafts and work with the earth with clay, not Play-Doh. What does it mean, the turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay? Well, one thing about shaping clay is that eventually, right? You see it getting stiff, you got to get the water and you got to still shape it the way you would like it. And one thing about it, when you leave it and put it in a kiln or leave it there and let the sun hit it, it dries. It dries. And once it's dry, whatever was made, however shape it is, you cannot change it. You cannot change it unless you break it and start over with a new batch of mud. The turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay. When the evildoers begin to shape lies for their new world order, lying against our people, lying on the Bible, what they didn't bank on is the fact that they were shaping something. That's right. And once the clay dried, that's right, we can point to the hands who made it. And actually, we can point to the lie that can never be turned or never be perceived as truth. It's been shaped already. Mm-hmm. It's been shaped already. And that's why the Lord said, the God said, let them go ahead and make their little pot. And I'll have you examine it later.
What's about to happen on Mount Sinai is absolutely insane. Religious leaders are gathering November 6th through the 18th for a ceremony they're calling Returning to Sinai, where they say that they're going to issue a new Ten Commandments to repent for man-made climate change. The website Interfaith Center for Sustainable Development has an article discussing the upcoming event titled In Sinai, a Prophetic Call for Climate Justice and Ceremony of Repentance. Mount Sinai is, of course, where Moses received the Ten Commandments, but these religious leaders are actually calling for a new universal Ten Commandments. In that article, it states the project partners will bring together premier religious leaders from the world's major religions to gather upon Mount Sinai to engage in a first ever climate repentance ceremony and to pull forth a prophetic interreligious call to action, climate justice, 10 universal commandments.
The turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay. Once it's made, we can point to who made it and the lie that was created by them. Our brothers and sisters don't know when they claim, hey, the Bible is a white man's book. You don't even realize it was a white man who programmed that into you. Mm-hmm. For self-hatred. Only thing you had to do was seek out of the book. So let's go. Let's go into the book, may we? Oh, but I'll tell you what. I got one better. I have one better. Hit that like button, folks. Help me out. I have one better. I have one better here. King James, the sixth and the first. I told you all I'm going to do a quasi Hebrew and Bible Academy presentation to show you how we do it in the Academy. Hey, folks. Hey, folks. There you go. Somebody get Tom Cruise out of that picture. Huh? Where you at? Where you at? Yeah, let me show y'all something here. Pull this up. Somebody, please. Now, somebody show me. We're gonna break this down now. Help us out here. Help me out. Help me out here. We're gonna get you in a second. Somebody show me here. Let me get it. Hold on. We got the browser. Oh, we going here in a minute. Don't worry about it. But we going to books real quick. We're going to get somebody, get John, oh, matter of fact, better yet, here's something even better. Every Hotep brother you know, tell them to come on in here. Huh? We got something for you. You non-believers, come on in. Come on in. I want y'all to check something out here. Now, who believe these people Who believe these people from British royalty? Who believe they came from this man right here? Who believe that these people, come on, right here, who believe these people came from these people? Yeah, we're going to get this right today. That's King James, folks. From the 17th century. A black man. Matter of fact, let me blow him all the way up. Look at that. I knew a guy in North Philly once ran a speakeasy looked like that. So who believe right now, who believe these people, let's get it, hold on, who believe these people came from this man? Here's the book right here. I got it right here. King James the 6th and the 8th, a black man who sat on three thrones at one time. Scotland, Ireland, and Great Britain. You see, I know we have lights here, so I wanted to make sure what I did. I took a picture, folks. I took a picture of the actual book. And folks, they couldn't whitewash this picture because what? This picture right here, brothers and sisters, was actually drew on cloth. Hence the reason they couldn't whitewash the pictures like the other whitewashed pictures of King James. They could not whitewash this without damaging the image, or they would have turned him white too. Do y'all know, brothers and sisters, that the so-called British family today isn't from Britain at all, or England at all? Don't you know that they are Germans? They are Germans. They're from the Wessex families. They, believe it or not, they are directly related to Vikings. Yeah. They're pagans. They're Germans. Now, once they were able to... Right? Let me show you. Why they had a problem with my brother, King James. Well, Elder Lawyer.
Yes, sir.
There's an opening statement that was made by King James himself concerning the translators he would utilize, right? To translate the book knowing that the enemy, the Edomites or the Romans, that the Romans would come in and begin to distort Christ's true ministry, his true doctrine. The last people on earth that anyone can trust is the Roman Empire, let alone the Roman Catholic Church. It's pagan. It's really Mithraism. It's the cult of Mithras. Is really what they've ushered out throughout the earth, using Christ as its catalyst. Christ was a black man. I don't have to state that. It's a fact. But I want to put it out there. Right? Now, let's go here real quick. Let's go back to where I was there. Real quick. Let's go to the next thing here. I also took this picture out of my King James Version Bible. A picture of what, one might ask? Well, it's the introduction that one would read, once opening the Bible. King James, the same black man I just showed you, who of great nobility. Let's read, Elder Lawyer, which says, in the grace of God, start from the top.
Yes, sir. To the Most High and Mighty Prince.
To the what?
To the Most High and Mighty Prince.
To the Most High and Mighty Prince. So when you hear Israelites talk, say the Most High, understand that name isn't something new. He's the highest God of all gods. And even King James knew him as the Most High. The highest of all gods. Right? Come on.
To the Most High and Mighty Prince, James, by the grace of God, King of Great Britain, France, and Ireland.
Okay, I needed to correct that. King of what?
King of Great Britain.
Great Britain.
France.
France.
And Ireland.
And Ireland.
Defender of the faith.
Defender of the faith.
Etc.
Etc. He sat on three thrones at one time. France, Ireland, and Great Britain. Okay? Y'all see that? France, Britain, and Ireland. But they won't tell us that that was a black man that sat on three thrones who ruled over Europe. They would have us believe that all Europeans are white people. That's idiocy in of itself, because we broke away from the Roman Empire once Rome was wounded. That's right. There was a revolution. Septimius Severus and Priscinius Niger. And before that, Christ's doctrine, his word began to fracture the Roman Empire. It began to divide the people, because you had people who started believing in Christ and our word, and you had people who believed in what? Mithraism and paganism. And through that, Caesar could not control the people under one ideology. So it's the fracture or the wounding of Rome started with Christ himself. But then our people revolted, took parts of Europe and set up black nobility, knowing that we were the children of Israel opposing the Roman Empire.
I've come to a city founded in around 71 AD by none other than the Romans. They called it Eburacum. Eburacum. Well, anyway, we call it York. And I've been lucky enough to bag myself another illustrious tour guide, historian Dr. Simon Elliott.
Hi, Dr. Simon. How you doing?
It's great to meet you, Alison.
We're heading into York Minster. One of the oldest cathedrals in Europe. But Simon tells me it's what lies beneath that is really impressive.
Simon, why have you brought me here to this dungeon?
Well, firstly, Alison, it's a crypt. So this is a place where the sort of rich people in York would have been buried from the medieval period.
So there's dead people in here?
You're actually sitting on top of someone's tomb.
Orcs.
What do you know about the Romans from being taught history?
Oh, well, I know Rome was not built in a day, that's for sure. Very good gladiators. I can remember Julius Caesar.
Well, it's really interesting you say that, because Julius Caesar is the individual, along with Cleopatra, which most people reference when they talk about the Roman Empire. And Caesar is also famous for coming to Britain. And a lot of people think that Caesar conquered Britain, but he didn't. So effectively, he came, he saw, but he didn't conquer.
Oh.
Now, the most important Roman, I would argue, who actually ever came to Britain was the African emperor, Septimius Severus.
Hold on. Let's just stop there.
Okay.
Are you telling me there was an African emperor?
There was an African emperor, and he was one of the greatest Roman emperors. So he was born in North Africa.
Yeah.
In AD 145, and he died here.
Here?
Here, right beneath your feet.
Oh my gosh, that's amazing. So
In York. This is where he would have lived. His bedroom would have been within 10 yards of where we're sitting, below us. Actually, I can show you what the family looked like.
Really?
Because we have a portrait here called the Severan Tonda. This is like a photograph.
Oh my goodness.
Of the Severan family. Are you ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
And there they are.
Wow. It's amazing to actually see his portrait. It's a black man, isn't it? I always remember the Romans being quite violent when I was at school. Was Severus nasty?
He was a warrior. He came here to Britain in AD 208. He got a message from the governor, and the governor said that we here in Britain are being attacked from the north and we're in danger of being overrun. The first thing he does is have them build the walls of Roman London.
Wow.
So the city of London, to this day, the square mile is defined by the African Emperor Septimius Severus. If you walk into the reception area of the British Museum, the first bust you see is a bust of Septimius Severus, alabaster white, but actually when it was in real life in the Roman world, it would have been painted as he was, a man from North Africa, a black man.
So no one would know that that was not a white man?
Absolutely right. This is a man who's there all the time. He's right in front of us all the time in the British Museum, but nobody knows unless you dig into the story that he was a warrior emperor from North Africa who stayed true to his own heritage.
This is just incredible. I can't believe I don't know about this story. And it's such a good story as well.
It's got everything. It's more Game of Thrones than Game of Thrones.
African Roman Emperor ruling Britain? How did I not know about this? And Dr. Simon's got another surprise up his sleeve.
There's an amazing artist called Daniel Vossart who specialises in creating realistic images of Roman emperors, and he's created this. I give you...
Wow! It looks so real, doesn't it? That looks so real.
If you look at his eyes, it's like looking into the eyes of a real person.
This African emperor has just completely blown my mind. It's completely changed my idea of the whole Roman Empire. I so wish I had known this as a child.
The Roman Empire is a truly cosmopolitan mixing pot of people from all over the Roman Empire.
He's powerful. He was a warrior. You know, he led from the front. People respected him. And most importantly for me is he's really fit.
Queen Elizabeth was a black woman. You know, matter of fact, you know, I'm going to save that for my classes because I have to pull out the class books and I don't got no time to Nature Knows No Color Line and all these other records. I have the records.
Well, I got this book right here. Negro Rulers. This is what this is. All right. The same mongrel people from Africa and Eastern nations migrated to Scotland, the British Isles, and the rest of Europe, etc., under the single name Moor, meaning black or Negro. All right, so I'm on chapter 9, Negro ancestry in the Anglo-Saxon race. As was said, there's evidence that Negroes or Negroids lived in the British Isles in prehistoric times and in the Middle Ages or Medieval Ages. From the 15th century onwards, there is an abundance evidence of them. Okay, so the Celts, the Anglo-Saxons, all those were people of color. The Welsh, the Black Scots, the Irish, those were black people. So a lot of you Negroes or blacks in America, your last name is not a slave name. That is a narrative that they told us. A lot of us come from Europe. A lot of our ancestors fled from the 30 Years' War, which was from 1618 through 1648. Religious wars, political famine, and plagues. Kind of like the plague we're going through right now with COVID-19. Through the three sons of Ham and Shem had for centuries mingled their seed, of course, whereby becoming a blend of one people whose universal identity became known as the Moors. All right. the Moorish Negro stewards of Scotland and England, who are the descendants of Kenneth the Nigger or Niger, claim their lineage go all the way back to the tribe of Judah, you know. So a lot of us, the black man in America is the Jew. You know what I'm saying? I don't know how many books, maps, I mean, I had to do this research on my own, but even original Christians were Hebrews or Jews or the Negro. This is our lineage. The book is talking about us. That's why they gotta hide it, and they put subliminal messages in movies. This is our history, man. You know, it's crazy though, right? Okay, so back to this. Let me see.
Hence the reason why, folks, when white women stole the throne once they took out King James and his son Charles, once they got rid of them, when a white woman was placed on a throne, they would put bells under her dress to mimic the derrieres of the black women who sat on the thrones before them. That's why you have all these old 1700, these old Victorian pictures and all that, with white women have bells under their dress to try to mimic what our women have naturally. Now, it's different. Now, they'll just go into the gym and do glutes. They go into the gym and try to work up and all that now to try to catch up. But all in all, brothers and sisters, this is why they have bells on the back of the white women dresses. Not that women now, some of them naturally just are shit. Elizabeth, and it's not racist, this is history. We're black people. He wants to remove my daughter from the succession. There was no BBL surgeries back then, okay? So let's get this straight now. Let's go back, Elder Lawyer. Ready?
Yes, sir. Starting off, it says here, the translators of the Bible wish grace, mercy, and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord.
The translators of the Bible wish grace, mercy, and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's right. As you can see, King James, a black man, believed in Christ.
You know this woman, don't you? Of course you do. But what about King James the 6th and 1st, the only child of her rocky marriage to the dashing Lord Darnley? King James traded his rattle for a crown as his mum was held captive and they never saw each other again. And when Queen Elizabeth I died, he inherited the English throne, becoming King of Scotland, England, Ireland and Wales, making history by uniting the kingdoms under one crown. A peaceful-ish ruler, James believed God had chosen him to rule. It was his divine right. As a Protestant, he was unpopular with Catholics, but survived Guy Fawkes and his pal's famous gunpowder plot. He was also a scholar, a poet, a theologian, and a patron of the arts. He made the Bible accessible to the English-speaking world with the King James Bible. But you knew all of that. Back to when King James was the King of Scots. When a violent sea storm nearly cost him and his Danish bride their lives, King James cast blame over a group of women that he accused as witches. Under his command, the women were tried, tortured, and killed in a period that became known as the North Berwick Witch Trials. This spurred a deadly wave of witch hunts throughout Britain, and in case anyone had any queries about witches, James penned a handy guide. Demonology offered tips on how to identify and resist these detestable slaves of the devil. rumour has it that Shakespeare himself used a bit of its witchy research as inspiration for his play Macbeth. James's determination to protect the Stuart dynasty was a triumph.
Fear of evil was endemic in England 400 years ago, when King James I was on the throne. James was living in fear of Catholic rebellion in the aftermath of the Gunpowder Plot.
John Wynne didn't know it at the time, but he just received a tip-off about the most notorious attempted terror attack in British history, the Gunpowder Plot. A small group of religious fanatics wanted to blow up Parliament, kill the king, and return Protestant England to the Catholic faith. The plot failed, but to this day, the 5th of November is celebrated across the country with bonfires and fireworks.
Recently arrived from Scotland, he was on the throne in a strange land, and some parts of his new kingdom were particularly troubling.
Lancashire was a long way from London in many ways. Described by somebody at the time as a dark corner of the land, it had a reputation for disobedience, full of troublemakers and subversives.
And this area, not far from where I live, dominated by the strange, brooding presence of Pendle Hill, was almost beyond the back of beyond. Today, it's established an odd niche by trading on its dark past.
400 years ago, one man launched a crusade against the forces of darkness.
To people who believe literally in magic, these are murder weapons, and they're terrifyingly effective.
That man was King James, the first ruler of both Scotland and England. He believed that Satan and a conspiracy of witches were trying to kill him.
I do not know Satan, sir.
What powers did Satan offer you? What diabolical promises did he make to you?
He even wrote a manual on the dangers of witchcraft. This is the story of how one... The urge to eradicate evil.
A real panic sweeps certain parts of Europe. If you want a quintessence of horror, go to a small North German town called Quedlinburg in 1589, where 133 women were burned alive in one day. It's a horrifyingly painful way to die. You're lucky if it's quick. You only need to burn about 20 or 30 people at a time, an average-sized North European town of the age, to create the impression of a forest of flaming stakes, and to ensure that if there's the slightest breeze blowing, the houses on the leeward side of the square, opposite the wind, are going to be coated from the cobblestones, the pavement, the roofs, with human fat.
In 1590, the full horrors of mass witch purges had not reached the British Isles. But King James was about to change that. The storm that had almost sunk his ship convinced James that Satan was trying to destroy him. The king now unleashed a war on satanic terror that would bring persecution and death to hundreds of his subjects. His fear extended to the widespread popular belief in magic. This now became a thought crime, punishable by death. In the 16th century, every village had folk magicians who used herbs and spells to cure illnesses, solve people's problems, or even influence the weather. These men and women were called wise or cunning folk. In the Museum of Witchcraft in Boscastle, Cornwall, there is remarkable evidence of the importance of magic in daily life.
This is a handwritten book of magic dating from the late 16th century, and it's the personal notebook of a wise woman or cunning man, and it is fascinating evidence of the role that magic played in people's everyday lives. It's a real mixture of herbal remedies, love charms, how to obtain magical objects. So this is a spell for obtaining magical stones out of a swallow. Take him out of the nest and cut him in the middle, and you shall find within the belly of it three stones of diverse colours. Virtue of the first is, if thou wilt give it to any woman that travaileth with child, she shall be speedily delivered. The virtue of the red stone is, if thou wilt put it in thy mouth, thou shalt obtain anything thou wilt demand. Healing magic was particularly important because doctors were very expensive. These traditional healers were really very central people in their communities, right at the heart of people's lives. And magic actually liberated and empowered ordinary people and helped them to cope with the challenges that they faced.
One of these healers was Agnes Sampson, who practiced in Keith in Scotland during the 1580s. Her clients included wealthy gentry as well as the very poorest. She had won wide respect for her work as a healer and a midwife. But she would soon become ensnared in one of the biggest witch trials in Scottish history. Healing magic could shield people from illness and misfortune, but it could also have darker purposes. It was believed to have the power to injure as well as cure.
This is a very striking spell because it shows how protection magic could blur into cursing. People did use curses, but generally in retaliation when someone had done them some wrong. And this is a spell to make a thief confess. You make a picture of an eye and then you drive a nail into the eye. The thief will then suffer pain in his eye until he comes and confesses to the theft.
Most of the objects here are for destructive magic. They're the classic image of a victim into which the person making the image inserts pins or daggers or other means of destroying their lives.
The church made no distinction between the good and the evil forms of magic.
To people who believe literally in magic, these are murder weapons, and they're terrifyingly effective. Orthodox, elite Christian belief can't really believe that magic can come from anywhere but the devil. The old practical folk distinction between good and bad magic, with magic being a neutral force, rather like any technology, is completely transformed in established Christian belief into a part of the all-out war between good and evil.
In March 1612, local JPs had received an order from London that they were to compile a report of all those who refused to take communion in church in an effort to root out the Lancashire Catholics. It was a crude but hopefully effective loyalty test.
All those that do not come to the church and there communicate must be presented and further proceeded against. Fail not herein at your peril. And here, look, one of the order's signatories was Roger Noel. There's no question about it. On Good Friday, 1612, every loyal subject should have been in church.
Right? Mm-hmm. He was a forerunner to do what? To hold the records true, knowing the Romans were seeking to distort the word and destroy our people by infiltrating it. Let's read it.
Yes, sir. Great and manifold were the blessings, most dread sovereign, which Almighty God, the Father of all mercies, bestowed upon us, the people of England, when he first sent your majesty's royal person to rule and reign over us.
Come on.
For whereas it was the expectation of many who wish not well unto our Zion.
He says there's many who wish not well unto our what?
Our Zion.
Unto our Zion. Let me show you this, folks. There was many. For whereas the expectation of many who wished us not well unto Zion. So the book starts out with King James making a proclamation. And here's the proclamation. I'm doing this because there's a threat on our people.
My sister was crushed like a seed. My brother butchered. They will be revenged. I am Robert Catesby. My purpose is to kill the King of England. I need to raise an army.
We mean to lead the Catholics of England out of their oppression.
I make the same oath as you. My name is Guy Fawkes.
People see how a king governs. They bow to me.
Bring me Catesby, Sir William.
God save the king! God save the
king! He must turn back.
I cannot. For the first time in my life, my purpose is clear. And my heart is full.
I will blow them all to hell.
When it comes to what? A connection to our bloodline. He knew that the Romans were threatening our bloodline as royalty as well as Hebrews. Oh, they didn't expect us to find this stuff. But there's more. There's more. Let's read it through, Other Lawyer. Ready?
Yes, sir.
All right, let's go to books here. So here it is. King James knew that he was a Hebrew. He knew that he was from Zion, not Africa. Not Africa. He knew we were from Zion. Finish reading, Elder Lawyer.
For whereas it was the expectation of many who wish not well unto our Zion, that upon the setting of that bright occidental star, Queen Elizabeth,
a black woman,
of most happy memory, some thick and palpable clouds of darkness would so have overshadowed this land that men should have been in doubt which way they were to walk.
It says, listen to this close. The bright and occidental star, Queen Elizabeth. And we have some information on her too. And what she was doing against, it was a lie that they claimed that King James had sex with his mother. And folks, by the time King James was an adult, his mother was in jail. His mother was arrested by these same enemies who were seeking to take the throne. Do your history. He was a homosexual. Another lie that was produced by the Bacon family. The Roman Bacon family, whom Kevin Bacon today is related directly to those Jesuits, those evildoers who were lying and coming up with new records to try to smear King James as some homosexual.
English natural philosopher Francis Bacon was a key figure of the scientific revolution. Today, many academics and educated lay people still take it for granted that Bacon was one of the first modern scientists, or an early spokesman for Western scientific naturalism. But historical primary sources reveal that Bacon was in fact a strong believer in alleged occult phenomena. In his writings, Bacon even suggested experiments to put certain strange effects to the test, only to advise against this kind of research in the end. Stay tuned to find out why and to learn more about Bacon's views on magic in the context of his time.
Oh, he had sex with his mother. Now, let me open the door for you there. There's room for you in the Antichrist room too. That's a lie. His mother was arrested when he was a child. King James had almost 10 children. He had a wife. And you know what? History is replete. There's no defense for a black man. If this man was white, there's no way Europe would allow his history to be totally defamed like this. You can't say one thing against Queen of England or Prince Charles without them looking at you a certain type of way. And we know they deal with all types of stuff. But they will allow negative history to follow this man? Why? They have the tools right now. They have the media. They have history on their side. They can easily just make sure they refute all these lies that are put out about this man. But why don't they? Because they know it was them who were responsible for his downfall as well as his son Charles. They know this. And these were all black people. Right? Now there's more. What dark cloud? Read that last piece again, Elder Lawyer.
It says, Queen Elizabeth, of most happy memory, some thick and palpable clouds of darkness would have overshadowed this land that men should have been in doubt which way they should walk or which way they were to walk, and that it should be hardly be known who was to direct the unsettled state.
Come on.
The appearance of your majesty as of the sun is in his strength, instantly dispelled those supposed and surmised mist, and gave unto all that were affected exceeding cause of comfort, especially when we beheld the government established in your highness and your hopeful seed.
And your what?
And your hopeful seed.
And your hopeful seed. And your hopeful seed. See that? That paragraph there? Look at that right there. I'm going to put it at the top so y'all can see it. King James was defending the physical seed of Israel and saying that they would come to distort the information that could free us in the record. See? He knew that they would come up with false ideologies that would separate us from Zion, that would keep us from ever realizing that we are the chosen people of God. Anyone who read the introduction to the Bible would know that King James was on our side to preserve the records for what you're seeing right now today. Someone who would stand in the true doctrine of the book he defended. Because without the book, as a people, we are lost. The Bible is our history book. Come on. I'm showing you how they turn things upside down. King James is actually letting you know right now. Read.
It says here, and gave unto all that were well affected exceeding cause of comfort, especially when we beheld the government established in your highness and your hopeful seed by an undoubted title.
By an undoubted title. You cannot doubt that King James was an Israelite. Read.
And this also accompanied with peace and tranquility at home and abroad. But among all our joys, there was no one that more filled our hearts than the blessed continuance of the preaching of God's sacred word among us, which is the inestimable treasure which excelleth all riches of earth, because the fruit thereof extendeth itself not only to the time spent in this transitory world, but directeth and deposeth men unto that eternal happiness.
That eternal happiness, read.
Which is above in heaven.
Which is above in heaven. This is a king, folks. He got the translators together knowing that the Romans were planning to re-educate and to destroy and to disconnect the chosen seed from God using the book as a prop, teaching a Roman doctrine that would separate us. He was against time now. They were politically looking to move him off the throne to put these white people on the throne.
The American people are proud to welcome Your Majesty back to the United States, a nation you've come to know very well. After all, you've dined with 10 U.S. presidents. You helped our nation celebrate its bicentennial in 1976. She gave me a look that only a mother could give a child. She gave me a look that only a mother could give a child.
Now that we know Vice President Dick Cheney and Senator Barack Obama are distant cousins, the New York Post decided to check into the genealogy of President Bush. And his family tree has people talking. Early show national correspondent Tracy Smith has the story of George W. Bush's many relations.
My honor to bring to you the 41st president, a great dad, George H.W. Bush.
We all know his father, but what about his cousins? Check out this family tree, done with research by Ancestry.com.
What would you say if I told you he's related to all of those people?
That you're wrong.
Oh, no, I'm not. Let me take you through this, branch by branch.
The 101st Airborne Division, air assault.
Vice President Dick Cheney, the man who's only a heartbeat away from the presidency, is actually a blood relation. He's President Bush's ninth cousin once removed. Cheney's cousin Barack Obama is also Bush's 11th cousin and the ninth cousin of Brad Pitt. But we're only just getting started. President Lincoln was President Bush's seventh cousin five times removed, and Bush shared more than just a ballot with John Kerry. That's right, their ninth cousins twice removed.
Bush. Really? What do you think of that?
Yeah, they have the same chin.
There's also royalty in the Bush bloodline. Princess Diana was Bush's 11th cousin twice removed. And then there's this bombshell.
Happy birthday, Mr. President.
Sure, she may have been singing to JFK, but what about GWB? He is, after all, her ninth cousin, three times removed.
Maybe it's the eyebrows.
They have the same eyebrows.
He's also related to Playboy founder Hugh Hefner, even Pocahontas, and Vlad the Impaler.
His Royal Highness Prince Charles, who can trace his ancestry back to Romania's dark and distant past.
The genealogy shows that I'm descended from Vlad the Impaler, you see. So I do have a bit of a stake in the country.
As it were.
For centuries, these moldering walls have been my gallows. And I'm bound to this cave, condemned by one who turned me. Oh, and I have waited an eternity for a man of your strength, your gifts, your will. A man worthy of the dark and all its powers. For if I am your salvation, you are mine. Drink. You will have a taste of my power, the strength of 100 men, the speed of a falling star, dominion over the night and all its creatures, to see and hear through their senses. Even heal grievous wounds.
At what price?
Once you drink, your thirst for human blood will be insatiable. Drink. Let the games begin.
To put who on the throne? Let me show you. Let me show you. He knew that eventually, folks, he knew the whole time that this was their plan. That was their plan, folks. This was their plan. That was their plan. That's right. To turn this brother to these people. And the bloodline of these particular people were an enemy to the throne. That was the last real throne we had in connection to our people being Israel. So this is why King James rushed to get 70 scholars together to translate the book into English, knowing that that would be the top language of the earth. He knew that this would be the language that would one day bring us back to Zion. A family he fought for. A family he died for. He knew, and he knew he was against what? Time. And eventually, he was out of the way, and Prince Charles was out of the way. And guess what? And after that, you had Edomites, Germans, who would eventually take on their names. Man, wait till I go into this tomorrow. Identifying the synagogue of Satan.
Alexander Stadium. A beast. A bull. 10 meters high. Heavily armored.
Now scarred by past hurt and enraged by injustice, the bull breaks free and causes pandemonium. And in a parallel act of emancipation, the women break their own chains.
Bulls were baited and sold here in the city century for centuries. And his armored mask features the names of the chainmakers embossed upon it from those dark days.
The turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay. And guess what? Elder Lawyer did me a favor. He came back from England bearing gifts. Evidence for the Bible. Thank you, Elder.
Yes, sir.
What's in this book? From head to toe, from one page to the next. The archaeological proof that everything Old and New Testament in the Bible is true. From an archaeological standpoint. Oh yeah, we're going to light our classes up with this. Huh? Now, there's more. Let's talk about Queen. Let me tell you, that sister was no joke. And guess what? She made sure, folks, she made sure her son, King James, went to the highest of schools. Educated well beyond any university you would learn under today. King James, a black man, not only understood politics because his mother put him into the right schools, let me tell you, he spoke 9 separate languages. You'll never hear about the greatness of King James because the last thing they'll do is to give us let us know the potential of our people. The potential of our men without outside influence. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. The demonology of King James. Oh, yeah. Folks, get into the next academy. That's all I can tell you. But I'm going to bring something out of this book, 2 pages. 2 pages on Queen Elizabeth, which was a black woman, and King James, who was a black man, who got scholars together to protect us, to give us this word to expose the evildoers in the last days. This is why I titled this, The Insane World Christ Warned Us About. They turned everything upside down. These people couldn't possibly be God's people that are running this earth. Because if they were the nobility that sat on the throne of King James who believed in Christ, if they're the people who have control over media, over the progression of society, on judgments against criminals, they would have the power right now to bring forth righteousness on this earth and to stomp out evil if that was their true intention as Bible believers or good people. The world that's being produced tells us outright the God they serve and have always served.
Between the dark and the light, the good and the evil, which will you choose?
See? They can't pull that con game out. Oh, let's believe in Jesus. Have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Folks, listen. You go to the Pope and ask him that. Lordy B, I'm an evangelist. Listen, don't come to us. Go to those who have the system to shout it out publicly to reach billions of people about the good message of Jesus Christ. See? If you're not coming with this book like King James was, leading with the hopeful seed for his people, we don't want to hear it. We don't want to hear it. Let me tell you, King James had the intellect. He also had the serious orative skills to total, and he was a great writer also, to totally decimate the Romans' empires. The ideologies and plans against Israel, he was able to highlight them and articulate it politically. He was a threat. But why don't they really talk about King James? Well, I'm going to show you now. Two pages. The demonology of King James the First, right? He was also the sixth of Scott. That's why I said Scotland, right? So let's break it down real quick, Elder Lawyer. Real quick. Boom. Let's move these usurpers out of the way. King James, that's his real image, how he looked. They couldn't whitewash this. King James was a black man. He wasn't a white guy. All right. So let's get that out of the way. All right. And now let's go. Let's go. In the book, Elder Lawyer, Demonology of King James. Now, the ignorant who don't know about the book believe that because there's a book titled Demonology of King James, that King James was a sorcerer. Boy, these ignorant people in the conscious community. They always talk about books but refuse to read them. Folks, this is why the Roman Empire didn't like King James or his mother. Why? Because they had rules in place. That's right, folks. Stringent penalties for witchcraft and evil that was instituted, executed, and upheld from the throne using the Bible. I didn't think your father. Elder Lawyer, read this here. Shortly after assuming the English throne in 1603. Let's read it.
Yes, sir. Shortly after assuming the English throne in 1603, James ordered a new edition of his book published in London so that he could extend his crusade against witchcraft into England.
Against what?
Against witchcraft into England.
Against witchcraft into England. That's right. He was setting up laws. That's right. That would destroy the spread of witchcraft. That's right, folks. Witches were what? A serious threat to the empire. They are the poisoners. They were the nurses who would get in certain places. They were the school teachers and educators who would get next to children. Read.
Neighbors, they don't
know. A Dutch translation was published in 1604, and Latin editions came off the presses in Hanover in 1604 and 1607.
Read.
A year later, his coronation, after his coronation, James succeeded in getting the 1563 witchcraft statute that had been enforced during the most long reign of Elizabeth abolished.
Come on.
And a new statute erected in its place that contains harsher and broader punishments for witches and practitioners of magic.
And practitioners of magic. Hence the reason witches had to go underground when it came to King James' reign. And now witches in our society are glorified, protected, incentivized. Hence the reason they had to get rid of it. Because why? Why? Why did he point out the witches first? Number one is why women seem non-threatening. Women appears non-threatening. Right? Let me show you something here. Right there. Witches are non-threatening. And the last people the Roman Empire would actually send forth to destroy us inwardly are sorcerers. King James, that's right, in his books, pointed out the papacy or the throne as a seat of Satan and called the Pope a sorcerer.
A great
like Gandalf. Look what he's holding in his hand, folks. A staff. Show me the Bible where someone in Christ is looking like this.
Against the power of mortal.
What scripture is this? See, we would have seen the men coming a mile away. But the greatest weapon society uses against its citizenry are witches. Because they come in unassuming. They come in non-threatening. And some people think witches is just about the witchcraft. Well, no, it's not just about the potions and the poisons with them. It's the ideology they bring to poison a society. So, and they become your maids. All up in your house next to your children, raising your children, teaching them anti-God rhetoric and ideology. Hence the reason why our schools are filled with them.
A family can be made up in many different ways.
It's called SOGI, for sexual orientation and gender identification, a curriculum that teaches public school students across Canada to celebrate the homosexual lifestyle and that gender is fluid. In other words, your gender is not dependent on what parts you were born with, but rather what you feel like in the moment.
There's people that are boys, there's people that are girls. There are people whose gender
might be a little bit of both, or might even be neither.
Lessons include books about transgender children, such as 10,000 Dresses, and songs like The Rainbow Song.
Gender won't decide the choices we make. Some boys like dressing up, some girls like catching snakes.
The SOGI curriculum started in British Columbia in 2016 and is quickly spreading throughout Canada.
I just thought, who decided that this was okay to teach our children?
Author and inspirational speaker Laura Lynn Tyler Thompson is a leading voice against the SOGI curriculum.
And we are seeing the results of that now, because some kids are reacting very emotionally and saying, you know, and they're in fear. Will I be, you know, will I suddenly struggle with feeling like a different gender inside of my body? No.
Carrie Simpson of Culture Guard, another leading opponent, calls the curriculum nothing short of child abuse.
All those beautiful qualities that make young girls, beautiful girls and women, are being basically vilified. The things that make our boys, boys, are being, you know, taken from them. So things of equating young men to being strong protectors is something that's now evil.
King James knew to get rid of the witches first.
Been found guilty of witchcraft and consorting with the devil. If you would save your souls from perdition, repent now and confess your sins.
I confess.
Go on, child. Did you sign a pact with Lucifer?
Yes, I signed a pact. I confess. Please, I beg you, have mercy on me.
I made ointments for a copper, but it was just pig spat, not witchcraft. I swear it.
Priest? You're gonna burn in hell.
Do it.
No! 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 Wait! Wait! You said you would spare me!
Your soul, child. Your soul will be spared, but the body must be consigned to God for absolution.
No! No, please! I beg you! No!
He knew to get rid of the witches first. Now let's go back. What part you left off at it? Come on.
So keen was James on this matter that his reinterpretation of the witchcraft laws went to the House of Lords for consideration only 8 days after the first sitting of Parliament of his reign as the English king and passed on first reading.
It says, A new statue erected in its place that contains harsher and broader punishments for witches and practitioners of magic. So keen was James on this matter that his reinterpretation of the witchcraft laws went to the House of Lords for consideration only 8 days after the first sitting of Parliament of his reign as the English king and passed on first reading. So the question here is, if these guys are really the people, the people of the throne, brothers and sisters,
despite what people think,
if they're really the family of the throne of King James, where are their laws through Parliament against witchcraft, sorcery, and evil doing? Like King James.
Close enough for villagers to watch.
But I digress. There's something else I want to cover before I go into a few other points I want to make here today. A few more things I would like to cover. Right? You see him? Let's go to books now. This is what a sorcerer looks like. Not someone who would be the authority over God's word. King James would have had a problem with someone rolling this position out as the highest position on earth to deliver Christ's kingdom. Right? Now there's more. There's more. Last but not least, this paragraph here in the book. In the book, and you get more of this as we go into the academy next. The Demonology of King James. Elder Lawyer, I highlighted it. I need you to read, starting with Under the Law of Elizabeth.
Yes, sir.
King James and Queen Elizabeth, two black people. They were black, the black nobility of Hebrews. Guess what, folks? You rarely hear this information. This book has nothing to do with witchcraft. It has everything to do with the laws that were being executed from the throne to get to rid England of all witchcraft. Using the word of God to highlight what people should be trusted. See? You cannot trust a witch.
Black magic, the invocation of evil spirits for evil purposes. It can be performed anywhere as long as those who wish to use it are capable and willing. So what happens when one of the strongest bloodlines of witches in all of European history perform one of their most extreme rituals directly in the center of a haunted forest known as the portal to the underworld? Well, tonight, that is exactly what we are here to find out.
They believe it's the largest portal in the world to the spirit realm.
What?
There's actually a case here where a girl went missing for
what?
5 years. The last place she was ever seen was here. 5 years later, she came back.
There are some sounds that you can sometimes hear in this forest, and people usually pick up.
Walk in the
someone
dark?
Just walked out of there in the dark.
Yeah. It's a whole person walking, dude.
Yeah, look at that. Yeah. You're leaving.
Yeah, I'm leaving. I'm not going there.
You don't see them right now?
Oh my god.
Yo. They actually have brooms that are on fire. So do they pray to the devil at all?
Yeah, exactly.
Game plan is we're splitting up. I'm going solo. Corbin and Jonah. I'm solo. Then Evan, Corey, Josh.
What?
Is there anybody out there? Oh!
What the f***? The witches left their broomsticks here.
It says angry! Angry on the obelisk! Right now!
Brandon, Orbit, what the f***ing balls?
Welcome to the Overnight Channel, dedicated to finding proof of the paranormal. Tonight's investigation takes place at Hoyabachu, Black Magic Ritual.
You cannot trust a witch. Let's read it.
Yes, sir. Under the law of Elizabeth, anyone who bewitched another without causing his death was subject to a penalty of 1 year in prison.
1 year in prison if you did witchcraft, but you didn't cause death. If it was found, that's right, that person would be what? Thrown in prison. Read 1 year. Come on.
The law of James made the same crime punishable by hanging.
But no, King James did it another way. If we find you doing any level of witchcraft, death or not, as a result, you're hung.
No, no.
That's right. We see you peddling potions or selling drugs, because that's witchcraft. You are hung under King James administration. Read.
Minor infractions such as using divination.
Divination.
To locate stolen property. Making love potions.
You're making love potions, or people coming to you and asking, well, my mother passed, or there was some property someone took from me. Can you give me some insight to where we can find it? Even if it was for a good cause, witchcraft was punished. When I say a good cause, some people go to witches and warlocks to find out who stole something from them, right? And some people might think, well, that's good. No. That's not good at all. Why? Because you are talking with the familiar spirit who requires something after the information. They don't tell you about this. That when you go to these people and leave out of the house, that spirit follows you. That spirit cleaves to you because you ask for it. That's what they're not telling you in witchcraft. That's the piece they refuse. We got it right there?
Mm-hmm.
That's the piece that these witches and warlocks don't tell you. That once you go and sit down with the diviner and sit with them and agree with them, the spirit you went to ask for answers, and they'll give you answers. When you leave out that door, that diviner don't care, because she conjured the spirit. She know that spirit will now attach to you and cause chaos throughout your whole house. So you went there for a good reason.
I asked for bear.
But that spirit doesn't stay there with her. That spirit leaves with you. You asked for it. See, and this is what King James was talking about.
Nina's waiting.
He says, no, you can't even use your witchcraft for good, because when you call a spirit, that spirit isn't dealing with the rules of man.
Filthy animal.
That spirit follows the person who asked for it and caused chaos in their lives and death in their lives. Folks, they should have told us this a long time ago. Horoscope readers, tarot card readers, all these things. That's right. Astrologers. They were killed under King James administration.
Sharp like yours when you bit her coot. And it's so cold and dark and wet like the jungle, like tears. I am crying. I am so afraid. Father, find me. Find me. Save me. Save me. Yonder moto koki ko tsunarangai. Tsunarangai. Tsunarangai.
Now you know why they use witches.
Black Lives Matter was really
witches, folks. Now we understand why they put black witches of our community
wrote a Facebook post, black people,
over the whole Black Lives Matter campaign.
Black Lives Matter. Patrice put
so that we can connect ourselves to their color, not realizing there was an agenda to destroy all of us connected with that.
Online and get people to do stuff together offline.
Alicia Open, I...
Come on,
there
let's
are
go.
Children
yes, sir. Minor infractions.
Hold on, let me go back.
Where they see themselves.
Minor infractions. Come on, where you at? Where? Right here?
Right here.
All right, throw out a little. Come on.
Yes, sir. Minor infractions such as using divination to locate stolen property, making love potions, or damaging property such as laming a cow or causing hail to flatten a crop in the field were still punishable by a year in prison and a term in the pillory. as they had been done under the old law. James caused it to become a felony to invoke any evil spirit.
It became a felony to invoke any evil spirit. Read.
Or to have any dealings with an evil spirit.
Or have any dealings with an evil spirit. It was a felony. This is real crime that King James is up against. Why? Because if you get in front of it, it doesn't affect the community. But if you allow drugs, potions, evildoers, African spiritualism, if you allow all this stuff in your community, it destroys it inwardly spiritually. Hence the reason why the conscience of the community is against the Bible.
See the rest of the sentence. Too much for me to get holes in. Look at that.
That's right.
Now it's the Holy Bible.
What?
That's right.
Come on.
This meant that to keep a familiar spirit in the form of a cat, dog.
In the form of a cat or a dog.
Rabbit or any pet was punishable by death.
Was punishable by death. That's right. Witches would conjure up spirits predominantly to using cats. This was their reconnaissance. That's right, reconnaissance for their neighbors. To use the cat's eyes to surveil the neighborhoods. Town watch for the witches. Come on.
The devil was thought to make those who with whom he had a pact. It says here, the devil was thought to mark those with whom he had a pact. To be found to have a witch mark anywhere on the body.
If you have a witch mark anywhere on the body. Now, folks, unfortunately, some of us have, not myself, but some people have gotten tattoos. This is known as a witch mark. A mark of someone who dealt with a familiar spirit where the spirit came into you and said, you will look nice with a heart on your calf. Everyone's doing it. But the mark of a witch or a warlock, and the occultists knew this, was tattoos. Tattoos. Right? That's right. This is why the occultists, when I was growing up, we all knew that tattoos were directly attached to the occult. Demons and spirits connect with familiar spirits or those who are marked in communication with them.
My head first. I'm bumping shit out of the way.
Read.
If it's something blocking me.
To be found.
Then I got the galaxy on my neck.
To be found with. To have a witch mark anywhere on the body was also enough evidence of consultation with an evil spirit to be punishable by death.
By death under King James. If you were found with tattoos. Back then, because that was a serious marking of those who crossed over to the occult, they were put to death.
Named Bridget Bishop.
Read.
Hence the vigorous questioning by the courts about familiars and the intensity of the search for the witch mark.
Come on.
The statute of James made it a crime punishable by hanging to.
Now, by hanging to. Hold on, let me get it here. Transfix us like this one. Come on.
So number one, invoke, consult, covenant with, entertain, employ, feed, or reward any evil spirit for any purpose.
To reward any evil spirit for any evil purpose. I see these people running around talking about blackness, and guess what? They're pouring out libations on people's graveyard, and you don't even realize this person is riddled with demons. Never look back. They're telling you that they're connected to the evil spirits.
Her father, she freed all of her siblings except one. One was so far south she couldn't find her, but everybody else.
I mean, what else do they gotta tell you? Not to support them or get away from them altogether. They're publicly pulling out libations on graveyards. She was born Ari Mendes. And our people are listening to them for information and insight.
Man. So she divorced them and married another.
You don't know a warlock when you see it? Oh, yeah. What he's saying about the white man is the truth. He's worse than the white man. He looks like you and is destroying our people inwardly. He's worse than who you fear or who you talk about.
People personally, thousands, uncounted. She took countless.
Well, Africans did it, so it's good. It's done in Africa. That's some of the most ridiculous, ignorant, stupid, outright stupidity. That's some of the most idiocy in responses I've ever heard, that it's good because they did it in Africa. Was it right or was it wrong? I don't care geography.
Hey, they did it in Africa, so it must be right.
Africans are suffering in Africa. So what are you talking about? Witchcraft is a threat to our people. Witchcraft, sorcery. Read.
Number two, take any dead body or any part of a dead body for use in any witchcraft, sorcery, charm, or enchantment.
Using a dead body for sorcery and enchantment. Another example is when people donate their body to science. You don't know, guess what, folks? They're doing a lot of stuff with those bodies. Read.
Number three, practice any form of witchcraft, enchantment, charm, or sorcery in which any person is killed, destroyed, wasted, consumed, pined, or lamed in the body or any part of the body.
Read.
Number four, aid, abet, or counsel others in any of the following or any of the above acts.
So you aid others into the bad, the evil activity. Read.
The statute also made it a crime punishable by 1 year in prison to use witchcraft, enchantment, charms, or sorcery to...
Or sorcery to do what?
Locate any treasure of gold or silver in the earth.
To locate any gold or silver or treasury in the earth. So it doesn't matter the reason you're doing it. If you were found doing it, read.
Or other hiding places. Locate any lost or stolen goods or things. Intend to provoke any person to unlawful love. Destroy, waste, or impair any chattel or goods of any or of another person. Attempt without success to hurt or destroy any person in the body.
In the body. Now, what scriptures was King James using to justify using the law, the government, to come after evil? And guess what? Even in the records, folks, it was the papacy seeking to cast spells on the James family. Whoa! When you do the research, the Edomites, the Romans, these are Edomites here you see on your screen, was using top witches and warlocks. Guess what? They were actually using Asian witches and warlocks. They were using Arab Asians and warlocks who would come into a room to pray against the Black King James. The greatest weapon Satan uses against society is witchcraft. Namely, the greatest vehicle he used to administer witchcraft in any society are women. Strategically, also honoring Eve's actions in the beginning, honoring Eve as the first witch. Amongst all of pagans, they honor Eve's action, even though she repented from it. They give honor to her as a goddess, as the first witch that would empower her with more knowledge to empower her in order for her to take power from a stronger vessel. One who was given the dominion on earth by God. They honor Eve as the first goddess or witch. Because through craft, she couldn't do it any other way, she was able to take power from the man. Man, wait till I go. I gotta do it. The next academy, we're going into that hive mind you were talking about. The hive mind. Elder Yurok put together a great presentation on the whole queen bee and the hive and how they would actually use that as an ideology to bring everyone under a certain mindset using women. Okay, that's why brothers have to flip their minds. They have to change their minds in this world. Just because someone look a certain type of way, you can't follow them and ask them for their number and all that. What you got to do is you got to build yourself up and have everyone in the world righteously follow you. And you make the choices. I'm going to make sure we add the hive mind. The Tower of Babel, Ceramicus, the hive mind in the next academy. And like I said, brothers and sisters, and I put it out there earlier, what I would like to do, because so many people are trying to come against it, I would like the next numbers of this academy to exceed any other numbers we've had before. To show the enemy that, guess what? Doesn't matter what you come against, you cannot stop this. We'll bring in new lessons, new like what you're seeing today. Some of what you're hearing today, folks, in your lifetime, you've heard it for the first time in your life. And now everything makes perfect sense. Why they put witches, warlocks, even in Pennsylvania, folks, they got the more number of witch covens than any other place in the United States.
Ashura.
And these become your school teachers. These become your nurses. These become your pediatricians. These become your doctors. All of that.
I don't know.
The first people that you're introduced to and your children are raised by.
Holy smokes. It's a match. Bring her.
Christ told us about this insane world. We got a world being ran by witches and warlocks. And wondering why this world has gone to hell. People are popping antidepressants. People are out of their minds and confused. The insane is running the asylum. And King James was trying to tell us.
Ashura has risen. We summoned her tonight.
His greatest work at the end of his life was to have these scholars come together and say, the only way to break the spell is that if we can translate this before my death. Because my people are going to learn a new language. They're going to be destitute, destroyed, and separated from Zion. Come on, Elder Lawyer.
Yes, sir. Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse number 9.
Come on.
When thou art come into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt not learn to do after the abomination of those nations.
Thou shalt not learn to do after the abomination of those nations. King James wanted us to know the law. He died. His family died preserving these records. The same records that a lot of our people are taking for granted. These pagan Christian churches, they're not defending what King James died for. They following the wizard. They are following the wizard. The same man who was responsible for what? The same people who were responsible for toppling our last throne in England. First of England, sixth of Scott. King James was a black man. And we're teaching the same doctrine that was in place before they destroyed King James. This is the true doctrine. Come on.
Verse 10. There shall not be found among you anyone that maketh his son or his daughter to pass through the fire, or that useth divination, or an observer of times.
Look at that.
Or an enchanter, or a witch, or a charmer, or a consulter with familiar spirits, or a wizard, or a necromancer.
Everything that King James, all of these is what King James put laws against. Straight from what? The power of his government. So don't tell me you don't have the power through government to get rid of wrong, crime, evil. You have the power. Only if you what? If you disagree with it. Understanding the end result of it. They know what witchcraft does and how it destroys a society. And that it actually aids and abets and actually it gives fuel to crime. They know that. Because this is how they let spirits loose all through the community. And we wonder why our people, you know, can't tell their head from a hole in the ground anymore. Our community is riddled with evil. By allowing witches and warlocks and evildoers, sinners and perverters. The only thing they would have to do is go to college and get a degree to be respected amongst us. And it's a shame that we're not really vetting these people. The only thing they have to do is go get a piece of paper and say, yeah, I'm respected. And no one has done a spiritual vet on this person. Okay, what school you went to again? Okay, what do you believe? Oh, well, I'm a spiritualist. Witch. Well, I don't really believe in any other religion. I'm really spiritual. Witch. Verse. It says, turn again. Well, listen, I don't believe in the God. I believe in the universe. Warlock. Sorcerer. See, this is why they don't want the Bible. You know, this is why they don't want the Bible and making decisions within our communities, folks. As far as the laws are concerned. Because they're easily, you can easily do what? You can easily vet people and discredit them and move them out of the way. Based on what? Their moral aptitude. Exactly. What they believe. What God they serve. They're sitting in a meeting with you. And they done brought the pits of hell demons with them. Come on, yeah, let's talk about solving this black problem. I don't like what the white people are doing. We black. Listen, you are a witch. I have no conversation for you. Okay? You are the black problem. Well, brother, I'm just here to help open up your chakra. No, wait right there. I got a door for you. Mm-hmm. Okay. They go to, there you go. You can get behind a woman with the yellow hair. Mm-hmm. Okay. You go into the Antichrist closet. You cannot solve the black issue without understanding the Bible and knowing who to separate yourselves from. Amongst our people first. Come on.
Verse 12. For all that do these things are an abomination unto the Lord, and because of these abominations, the Lord thy God do have drive them out from before you.
The Most High will drive them out before you. Before the sun went down, Elder Lawyer, make sure y'all hit the like button real quick. Y'all, I'm about 100 likes down. Do that for me real quick and hit the likes. Before the sun went down, we went to get something to eat real quick. Mm-hmm. Drove off the highway and seen a whole line of people. The majority of them were college students. Majority of them were European. They were white. Standing in line at a marijuana dispensary. The line went around the corner. It's like two of them. Like Taj Mahal. Looked like they was in a crack line. I'm like, man, it was one thing when they let this stuff loose on us outright. That was one thing. But you know they don't care when they allow their own children to fall to these synthetic marijuana dispensaries. Because, folks, they already told you, this isn't marijuana. Okay? This stuff have hallucinogens and all types of agents from... what it's called, LSD? Yeah, it's almost to the degree, not too much, to the mushroom tabs that have people tripping with psychedelic. They put psychedelic stuff in the marijuana. See, King James would have killed all this altogether. Anybody thinking about doing something like that during King James' time was put to death. Because you cannot think about this. Have a organized, righteous society with children who are high out of their minds connected with demons. The demons, according to the book of Enoch, it tell you it came from the Nephilim, the children of darkness. And eventually It doesn't matter. They'll give you some understanding to be next to you, but they can't help but cause chaos.
Do show up, it's a sure sign that carnage and bloodshed are not far behind.
Warning.
They don't cause it, they feed on it. The more Bodex that show up, the bigger the eventual feast. They are attracted to evil like bees to flowers. They know when death is coming and want to watch. They don't show up for any ordinary death. They want extreme, operatic violence and terror.
That's all they can do. They can give you information because they were there since the beginning. They can give you information, but not without a trade-off. I'm going to cause chaos in your life, and I'm going to cause chaos with your relationships, your family, and eventually, I'm going to kill somebody up in here. That's what they're saying. They're going to kill somebody up in here. Evildoers knew it. If the government really wanted to go against crime, they would do what? They would round up all the witches and warlocks first. Get them out of places that, you know, because these people strategically, intentionally get next to children. Usually they find a place where they can indoctrinate. Daycare centers, hospitals, schools. They love the schools. And these are those who be radicalized out of their minds. You send a young man, a young woman to one of these universities, and they come out of that the university whacked out of their minds, sexed out of their minds, whacked out of their minds.
That shall not be revealed. Nothing hid that shall not be known.
The best word I can.
Y'all, we in the
they become radicalized, and they come out with a liberal type of mindset that, you know, oh, the white patriarchy and all. These people are under a spell that go to these universities.
So you can be free from spiritual bondage if you have been ever caught up.
And then they expect us, once you've been totally torn apart mentally in these universities, you expect someone to accept you and want to be with you.
Even if they're to realize that God is the true Alpha and Omega of all.
Master then totally twisted your mind.
God of the Freemasons and the sororities and fraternities were created.
Witches, warlocks, come on.
Yes, sir. Exodus 22. Verse number 18.
Come on.
Thou shalt not suffer a witch to live.
The Bible tells us that we're not supposed to suffer a witch to live. King James enforced this. His mother enforced this. And again, let me show you here. These witches and warlocks like this guy and the bloodline of Esau. Well, they eventually got King James out of position and his son Prince Charles out of position. Who is this? This is the original King James right here. Right here. Now, there's more. He was against all types of craft. And here's the book right here. Get it yourself. In the book, he speaks against the papacy, the Roman Empire.
Hey everyone, I'm here today at the Vatican to show you that this church is not just unchristian, is actually anti-Christian, in that the Vatican, which is run by Luciferian secret societies, is quite literally a temple of the Antichrist. They use imitative magic to make you think it's a Christian place, when actually it's representing the Babylonian gods. Why do you think there's so many symbols relating to cracking through time and space and lifting the veil? Even the root word of pontiff is bridge. And cardinal, the root word is hinge of a gate. The whole setup of the Vatican is designed to pay homage to Babylon.
It's Antichristo! The new world order will fail!
Why do you think they keep constantly mirroring and copying and inverting these things? Because it's a religion that is actually at its very heart with the Jesuit conspiracies and secret societies. They're trying to break the veil and bring through the Antichrist. Biggest lies of this whole masquerade is that this is built on St. Peter. That's one of the hinges that it stands on. When in actual fact, there's a lot to say that Peter himself wasn't in Rome, and that this is actually a Gnostic religion. And I'm not saying there's not true believing people who are in the Catholic Church that truly believe in the gospel of Christ have been misled, but I'm saying come out of her, my people, because this is a masquerade that is leading to the great deception, and that's the danger of it.
King James VI and the First, a black man. Folks, I'm going to take a small break and come back with some of Christ's words. But before I do that, let me make it clear. When we released this video in 2012, we released a video, The Truth About King James Online. Don't you know that England banned the video from getting viewed on YouTube? Now, this was before Google and others purchased YouTube, folks.
My point is, why won't they do anything to clear up the lies?
They restricted this video on King James. We still got it on our channel. We have it on our channel. They restricted the video in England from being shown. If you go to YouTube and you were living in England, guess what? It would be blank. It was black, and they would say you cannot view this here.
Up a whole new can of worms, don't.
And this was before YouTube censorship.
These black people get in England and move in England.
And I said, whoa!
With nobility by J.A. Rogers, showing black.
Whoa! This thing isn't just about what, this is not what's resonating amongst the populace. This thing is resonating in high places amongst their so-called royalty. That's an executive decision to tell people, because if it's wrong, the only thing we did, brothers and sisters, was bring out the true history of King James, what he looked like, dispelling the lies that he wasn't a homosexual, he didn't deal with no witchcraft, everything about him. We just set the record straight. And I would have expected England to commend us for setting the record straight. And if it was false, they would use their media to disprove it.
Don't they want everyone to respect the Bible?
Folks, don't you know, you try to pull this video up in England, the truth about King James gathered the Christ Church, it goes blank. They won't allow it. Right? Why, folks? Because they would have you believe that we were predetermined and that there was never any royalty and that we were civilized. We were predetermined to be slaves under Europeans. They would have us believe that before the civilized white man came and civilized us, and we were swinging through trees with strings up our behind with dirt on us. And when we came of age, we got a cup, right? And say, please send 30 cents. We have a cup and say, please give us some rice, and you know, with big bellies. That's the only thing they wanted to show concerning who we were historically. You must be African, and I'm going to show you what an African looked like. Send 30 cents a day for this child here with a big belly and flies around him. Folks, that's their game. Their game is to make us believe that we're not tied to the righteous, that we don't have a strong bloodline, that they're trying to disprove everything we're saying through their media without actually saying anything.
Your slaves sure do know how to behave.
That's right. They just saying that I'm right. Look at the African, and look how Africans are betrayed, and that's the most you can aspire to. Let me tell you, I don't have no problem with Africa.
Superboy killer, yes.
I don't have a problem knowing that my people once lived in Africa, but that's not where we're from. Let's get it real quick, and we'll take a quick break, and I'm going to do about 15, 20 minutes and make an announcement after that. I may have to switch up this title because it's good, but I went more so into King James and his mother. But let's read this real quick. I touched on it. I'm going to go further into it in our next academy. Let's get it real quick, Elder Lawyer.
Yes, sir. This is Galatians 4 and 26. And verse number 26.
Yep. Galatians 4 and 26. Read it.
But Jerusalem, which is above, is free.
With Jerusalem, which is above, is free. Read.
Which is the mother of us all.
Which is the mother of us all. That's where we came from. Zion, Israel, the same Zion King James stated he was here to defend. Read. I had to revise it. I was getting off topic. Read that little... That little man, folks, all you have to do is go to your Bible and read what was almost a monologue where King James is telling us the reason he worked politically to put the best translators in one room for what? The greatest book that has ever graced the earth. The King James Bible. You might perish if you forget about it. Do the works right. Yeah. Read it. From Jerusalem. And he tell us we're not from Africa. This captivity ain't permanent. Right? They say Jerusalem above is free. It's the mother of us all. We ran into Africa in 70 AD, running from Roman persecution and slavery. And then after that, we've been going downhill ever since. The Edomites came through and pillaged and converted us and hurt us. The Arabs, bringing that religion, Islam, a new religion, came through pillaging, converting us. I have a book to tell you that they came to certain villages and said, if you don't convert to Islam in Africa, we're going to kill everyone in this village. That's right, Islam was pushed on our people through the sword, and I got the records to prove it. And now you got our people, simple as a days old, peddling and upholding a religion with the blood of your people on its sword.
Assalamu alaikum, brother. You making Hajj?
It's time for afternoon.
Disgracing your forebears.
Muslim inmates in this California state prison are doing what was
they
once
came through
forbidden.
Africa and an decimated Africa. And now in China is saying it's my turn
to teach and to practice.
And you still have these people, simple as a day's old, glorifying and sensationalizing Africa as a con. Muslims. Africa is what a product of our captivity.
It's so fluid.
And everyone in Africa now understand what time it is. They're trying to get out of there. They are desiring something better. We're Israel, folks. And we're living in the insane world Christ warned us about. Hold tight, we'll be right back with part. Shalom, shalom. Yeah, I wanted to make one correction real quick, and it is correct because I did read it in the book. Queen James' mother was Mary, Queen of Scots. Mary, Queen of Scots. Mary, Queen of Scots, okay? When you look into the research, the relation of Elizabeth would be more so in the bloodline of his aunt, who established certain rule, and he came in and established after that, okay? So, but King James' mother name was Mary, Queen of Scots. I just wanted to correct that. All right. Now, let's jump right in now. Matthew 24.
St. Matthew chapter 24, verse number 1. And Yeshua went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple.
Come on.
And Yeshua said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down.
Come on, there shall be what? Not one stone above another that shall not be thrown down. Okay, come on.
And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world?
What shall be the sign of thy coming and the end of the world? Now, this is the insane world Christ warned us about. Right? And really, all of these prophecies you're about to hear is the Gentiles scurrying and clamoring at the very end to consolidate or to keep the power that was given them through our fall. They'll have to do all these things in the earth to keep power. So this is the direct reaction to what? Israel awakening is awakening out of sleep. So now the Gentiles have to scurry to move to consolidate and keep the power from Israel rising. Right? He says, these are the things you got to watch out for. Read.
Yes, sir. Verse 3. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, his disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world?
And of the end of the world. Read.
And Yeshaya answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many.
Many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive who?
Many.
And shall deceive many. Many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Christians. So Christ didn't say, well, don't look to Islam. Don't look to the Dalai Lama. Don't look to Buddhist teachings. The main deception is going to come through those using my name in title. Hence the reason why most people don't trust Christians. And by default, they don't trust the Bible. Not realizing Christ warned us that deceivers would use the Bible. Not in its proper context. But they would use it. They would have the Bible in front of them lying to people. That's right. Like your Roman Catholic Church. And all the harlots who stemmed from her. All of the churches that came, that we see exalted in the Western world, Protestants, Catholics, Baptists, they're all harlots, according to the Bible. An extension of the lie from the so-called Holy Roman Empire, which is really Mithraism. It's the secret cult of Rome, is the religion this world is under. Read.
Verse 6, and ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars.
Wars and rumors of wars. And folks, people, you have to realize what the wars are about. Israel is scattered throughout the four corners of the earth. They set up an international confederacy against our people to keep our people under wraps. All nations agreed with this. They tell you that in Psalms 83. So here it is, nations against nations. It would normally come into play when some nations began to do what? Break the alliances. Give our people ease and start working for God's people instead of working against them. Now the Roman Empire is going to stand up and say, nah, we have to put you under order. If you free these people, they'll gain a platform to free the rest of them. We agreed to keep them down forever. Hence the reason when Gaddafi gave Farrakhan all those millions of dollars and say, this is not enough, but this is some payment for what Islam did against your people. That's right. Y'all don't know Gaddafi gave Farrakhan some money and said, historically, Islam have destroyed blacks, and we understand this. No sooner as he did that, a few years later, he was what? Libya was overturned, and that's right, re-educated under the order.
This is not where these migrants want to be, heading back to the African continent, thanks to aid from the Italian government to reinforce Libya's Coast Guard. It's helped cut the number of migrants arriving in Italy to under 22,000 in the last 3 months. It's the lowest total for 4 years. But people trafficking networks in Libya continue to flourish because of government chaos as rival groups battle for power. These Ivorians, repatriated to the Ivory Coast from Libya, say they risk being sold into slavery.
They sell Africans over there, in Libya. They sell men. Even 15-year-old Libyans are there in a car, they're armed. They'll come and kidnap you, and they'll sell you for $70 to $150. And then others will resell you.
As soon as you arrive in Libya, the first thing that happens is that you are taken away and sold. Our black brothers from West Africa, wherever you are from, a Malian, a Senegalese, or any other nationality from the West, even an Ivorian, you are sold. And for what? $700.
But these migrants will tell you that life is so hard in their home country that it's worth almost any risk to make a new start in Europe.
Now, with the advent of the smartphone and with Facebook and others pushing into Africa, a youngster can meet a smuggler in 2 seconds on a phone. Now, nothing has been done to challenge that. They think they're following a dream to Europe. They end up in the maw, in the grip of these rapacious smugglers.
Despite increased patrols, the UN says more than 160,000 people have made it across the Mediterranean to Europe this year. About 3,000 have drowned en route. Bernard Smith, Al Jazeera.
These wars and rumors of wars is because what? These are the countries Esau leading to come against the countries who are now trying to break the Confederacy, trying to break the alliance and keeping our people down. Look what happened with Iran. Years ago, you had Mahmoud Ahmadinejad. He came out and said, well, hold up. No one can talk about human rights violations and what countries should be highlighted concerning them in comparison to you talking about what we're doing or what other people's doing. You got more people, blacks, in prison in your country compared to any other country on earth. This is what Mahmoud Ahmadinejad said. Lies. He says, how can y'all be the protectors of human rights and telling us and others what we're doing wrong when you have the blacks enslaved in your prisons? Not that I'm for him either, but here it is. He's breaking ranks. He's not supposed to internationally tell everyone that really the game is to keep us down. That we're supposed to be politically under all nations publicly. What others are doing to us are not supposed to be what? Protected from an international platform. They're breaking the alliance. So he spoke about what they're doing to us. And that, guess what? They talking about going to war with Iran. Anyone who's not in agreement with keeping our people down has become public enemy number one. Look at all the countries that they look to topple. Even when I traveled over to the Middle East, brothers and sisters, I had Arabs tell me straight out, listen, we never have no had a problem with you, with blacks. They do like this. We never had no problem with you. We the same. That's what they tell us. And then they would say, listen, we know you're the sons of Jacob, Bani Yaqub. That's what they told me in the Middle East when I traveled over there. So the nations know. So when Christ says wars and rumors of wars, it's the uprising of the economies and all that that comes with the awakening of our people who have now cleaved through the Bible. Their economies has actually been built on, yeah, the enslavement of the children of Israel. So when a country says, listen, let's ease up on them, let's now get on the right side of this, knowing that these people will rule one day. No, the New World Order is saying, nah, attack that country and put them under the order. Whose order? Rome's order. If there's a campaign we're going to roll out, We'll roll it out over in China. We'll roll it out over there. And then at the end of the day, we're not going to let the people know it's really a bio attack on a specific people. At the end of the day, we're going to tell them these people need the cure more than anyone else. Bio wars, physical wars, is what the Bible is talking about. A war against the people of the Bible. Read. Christ told us about this insane world we're living in right now. Read.
Yes, sir. Verse 6. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet.
But the end is not yet. He's telling us. He's giving us comfort, saying, listen, listen. These things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. Endure through them. Stand with me. And I'm confident that we in Christ will make it to the other side if we endure. And not get what? Taken or overwhelmed with what's going on real time. We have to look at this and say, I'm not going to let this current circumstance consume me. Christ said this would happen. This is what we're being faced with. I'm not going to let it consume me. This gives me confidence that the word of God is true. I'm confident that I can get through it now. I'm not going to let it, trouble me. I'm going to have what's going on in the earth, how bad it is, empower me to get through it. See? Read.
Yes, sir. Verse number 7. For nation shall rise against nation.
Race against race.
And kingdom against kingdom.
Kingdom against kingdom. This is what happens when the service class no longer participates. When the service class is saying, I wasn't born to serve you. It topples kingdoms. It topples economies. And it makes it where they have to now move to the next. To the next world economy. And how, really, because the economy is set up to control the specific people. To keep a certain people in perpetuity under or as a service class. That's what all of these constructs, these economical constructs, were set up for. To keep us as the servant class. Right? And now our people are saying, well, hold up. We're not African. They told us in the church that we were enslaved, living the curse of Ham's son Canaan, a servant of servants. And through that gave me a biblical understanding to why it was okay to serve white people.
I lead you to Peter.
See? Now, if they're going to give you some servant scriptures, they're not going to give you Deuteronomy 28. They're going to tell you, you're from the seeds of Ham, cursed son Canaan. Right? So when we realize, hold up, we're not from Canaan. There's no historical proof of this. There's no biblical proof that blacks in America and others, Africans, are from the seed of Canaan. When we started seeing that we're not from that, and the Christian church taught us that. The enemy is behind this, which is a sorcerer. The sorcerer is behind this. The sorcerer is behind this. He started teaching out there that our people being black was from the cursed seed of Ham. That was a lie. Yeah, so once we realize that we weren't born to be servants, it affects the economy, folks. It affects it. And now the elite powers are coming together and saying, we got a problem. They know now. And it's affecting our bottom line. It's affecting our economy because now they don't want to participate as servants. They're asking the right questions. They're asking the right questions and they want resolution and will not accept our political answers for them. They know they're Israel. What are we to do? We have to tighten the economy. Well, they got their own money. Let's change the money. If they don't participate, block them out of society. and then they'll serve. They'll serve willingly. We'll institute the mark of the beast, and if they don't accept it, they're actually economically severed from society, and then see what God they'll bow to. Mark of the beast. They change their economic system based on how conscious we are concerning the prophecies for our people going forward. This is how they shape the economies going forward, and it's leading to wars all over the earth, because now the world knows. Read.
Yes, sir. Verse number 8. In fact, the rest of verse 7. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places.
That's right, folks. There's some forums out there who are saying that hunger is a good thing. I'm going to be showing that. I'll bring that out in the academy tomorrow. How hunger benefits the future of Earth.
And I do believe that we have rotten politics, and I'm not using that as an exaggeration.
Hey everyone and welcome. In this video, we're going to be having a look at world hunger. Now, as you're probably aware, the supply lines have all been broken because they're playing Billy Big Balls with the sanctions on Russia. And as such, most of Europe and most of the world are struggling with food shortages. On top of that, we've got the EU trying to completely dismantle Danish farming to the extent where they're now actually threatening to confiscate farms if they don't reduce their nitrogen production by up to 90%. So effectively making it unviable as a business. Well, it seems that the United Nations have gone one better than that, and they've actually produced an article in the UN Chronicle by an author, George Kent, that I think is abhorrent on so many levels and completely wrong, so I thought we'd have a run through it. The title of the article is called The Benefits, remember that word, Benefits of World Hunger. Now, before we actually get into the article, let's have a listen to who the author is, shall we? George Kent is a professor in the Department of Political Science at the University of Hawaii. He works on, are we ready for all of these? Human rights, international relations, peace, development, and environmental issues, with a special focus on nutrition and children. Not ominous, that at all, is it? So let's get into the article, shall we? We sometimes talk about hunger in the world as if it were a scourge that all of us want to see abolished, viewing it as a comparable with the plague or AIDS. But that naive view prevents us from coming to grips with what causes and sustains hunger. Hunger has great positive value to many people. Not to the people that are hungry, though, eh, everyone? Indeed, it is fundamental to the working of the world's economy. Hungry people are the most productive people, especially where there is a need for manual labour. Do these people not understand that to do manual labour, well, this George Kent obviously doesn't understand what manual labour is. To do manual labour, you need energy. To get energy, you need food. It's not rocket science, this is it, everyone. We in developed countries sometimes see poor people by the roadside holding up signs saying, "We'll work for food." That's people that are starving. Actually, most people work for food. Obviously, in a roundabout way, because everybody needs food, you absolute buffoon. It is mainly because people need food to survive. Woo, he's got something right. He's actually figured out a bit of logic. To survive, that they work so hard, either in producing food for themselves in subsistence level production, or by selling. We're not doing subsistence level production at the minute, are we? With globalism, we're just passing it off to other nations so that they can hold it over us like a carrot on a string, or by selling their services to others in exchange for money. How many of us would sell our services if it were not for the threat of hunger? Well, I would. I'm sorry, but this may apply in third world countries where everybody's starving, but in the Western world, we'll work for food means that you are starving. It means you are getting no help and you are starving to death. It's not got anything to do with I'll work better because I'm hungry. This next part is the interesting one for me. More importantly, how many of us would sell our services so cheaply if it was not for the threat of hunger? When we sell our services cheaply, we enrich others. Here we go with the communism. Those who own factories and machines and the lands and ultimately own the people who work for them. For those who depend on the availability of cheap labour, hunger is is the foundation of their wealth. Now, let me just say this. This is a professor that's saying that. So one of the upper echelon, one of the elites of society. So if anyone's benefiting from cheap services and people selling their time, as he puts it, it would be him and his ilk. So this is everybody else's fault but me, isn't it, everyone? And it's completely communist, in my honest opinion. The people sell their time on a contract. It's got nothing to do with abuse. It's got everything to do with getting a better deal, in my honest opinion. Now, obviously, mass migration has changed that slightly. It's changed the style of that a little bit more. There is a lot more competition now, and there's thus a lot less work. And we had the EU stripping us of all of our industry, didn't we?
Because Hungary people aren't asking for raises. They're just asking for any work to sustain or survive. How making a country or a city or a village hungry can politically benefit the order. To have a people accept the position of servitude. Read.
Yes, sir. Verse 8. All these are the beginning of sorrows.
All these are the beginning of sorrows. What sorrows? Jacob's trouble. Read.
Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake.
Use the laws to come against those who are right. And those who believe in Christ will be hated. Now, hold up. How can those in Christ be hated living in a majority Christian world? Huh? Think about that. It's really the Christians out there in number that I see who are Christians who hate the fact that we're telling the truth. Whose side are you on? Shouldn't you be the hated? Shouldn't the whole world hate what you're dealing with? But the world embraces you because you're of the world. You're not really under Christ. You've been deceived by the wizard. That's your daddy right there. Look at your daddy. The same daddy King James was against. Elizabeth was against. Come on.
Yes, sir. Verse number 10.
Come on.
And then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise.
And I'm gonna tell you, everyone, I'm looking at this on either side of how it's gonna play out, brothers and sisters. I'm gonna show you exactly how this is gonna go down. Make sure you snip it, clip it, keep it, because this is how it's gonna go down, folks. All the people who didn't listen. All the people who didn't listen are gonna become betrayers. All those who are feeling a certain type of way and all that on the sideline and aren't doing the right things, these are gonna be the people, because when the food dries up and the resources dry up, this is how it's gonna go. They didn't listen to prepare, but they're gonna expect those who did prepare to sustain them. And they're gonna be knocking on your door or coming around saying, I know what you got because you told me how to get it, but I didn't prepare for it. You either give it to me, help me out with it, or I'm telling. Either you help me out, or I'm showing everybody where you are. Folks, this is not going to go down, folks. And I know a lot of our people are naive and think that this can't happen like this, folks. I'm checking out how the other nations are preparing. They're saying it straight out. They're preparing for a broke down society with no police and no authority over the people.
Across the country, ordinary Americans from all walks of life are taking whatever measures necessary to prepare for what they perceive as the end of the world as we know it. Next, we go inside the lives of three committed preppers to see if they have what it takes to survive.
This is Doomsday Preppers.
I talk to them, I listen to what they're saying privately, and they're preparing for a total. That's right. A total breakout of society. A purge. They're talking about how they're letting the criminals loose. They're doing this. Other races of people in the suburbs are talking about it and actually prepared for it. And when it talks about this, Christ told us about this insane world. The same Christians who didn't listen and all of that, and even our family, they're going to be coming to us saying, listen, I thought you believed in God. You know I'm doing bad. I know what you got. A matter of fact, you was telling me about what you had. You either give it to me or give me some of it, or I'm telling. I'm not dying out here alone. Either you help me out or we're all dead. Now, reading the Bible, I can see real time what Christ was talking about, the betrayal. The betrayal is going to be in place. It's going to be all about survival. That's why they're going to betray. You have people knocking on your door with their baby crying and all of that. Mm-hmm. Saying, I seen you online. I thought you was with Christ. I thought you was down. Let me in. I got a crying baby. Watch how it happens, folks. Because why? In the time of the plenteous, no one is preparing. You're not preparing because a lot of our people think there's going to be a famine forever. I mean, it's going to be plenteous forever, our people. They're not looking at their supermarkets where the supermarkets is showing, is giving an illusion of food. They're putting big boxes on the shelves to make you, to actually compensate. So that we don't see the shelves for what they are. They're putting the little things up with nothing behind it. I went to Best Buy the other day and I'm looking, everything is online and got many shelves with nothing but boxes on it. Big boxes so that you don't ask, well, what happened to all the products up in here? That's how it's going to happen, folks. People not preparing now, and the betrayal is going to come when they know where you are and what you have and let you know that right now it must be shared. Get ready. I've already made it clear. Listen, my responsibility first is to those who are in the work and those who are amongst the body. That's my responsibility. That's who Christ called in so that we can actually work together through this. That's my first responsibility. And then the blood family who believe. Then my personal family who believe. You're going to have people coming out of the woodworks, folks. And I made it clear. I even made it clear to my immediate family. If you don't get it right before that time come and the doors close, let me tell you, don't get upset because you're going to know a different person. The Bible says he sent for fishes first and then hunters. And I'm not going to allow you to bring some death into my home. What we got now is fishes, teachers. But what we got coming afterwards is those to protect the resources the Most High entrusted in us to protect to help people who believe. Come on, only got a few more.
Yes, sir. Verse number 12. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold.
Because of iniquity shall abound, evil. The love of many shall wax cold. And it waxed cold because what? We're living in a world where those who have standards aren't going to accept the foolishness. Well, God loves everybody. No, if you're dealing with all types of perversions and different sexualities and all type of witchcraft and sorcery and evil, let me tell you, We don't have nothing to do with you. You're of the God of this world. And because iniquity abounds, you got people who are trying to do right rejecting people. And they're going to be like, well, how can you do this to me? I thought you was in Christ. No, Christ said, repent. We're not here to be your life raft. We're not here to be your life raft. Christ said, repent. You can't just live the life you want to live. And when things break down, hold on to us in the last minute for survival. No. You come in now. You start working for what's to come, for the preparation now. Read.
Verse 13. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved.
He that gets through this, the same shall be saved. Christ told us about this insane world.
Zombie epidemic and alien encounters continue unabated. Safe to say, this is the best.
Get down!
Leave this!
Like the infidel you are!
And folks, they're going to cut off Section 8. They're going to cut off welfare. They're going to cut off Social Security. They're going to cut off disability and show the world, our community in particular, the reality of our lives. We're going to see at that point what we've really worked for in this earth. It's easy to say you got it going on and I'm a boss this and I'm a boss that, when you're only paying $9 a month for a roof over your head. They're going to cut it all off. It's part of the New World Order. The only way you're going to get free housing from the devil is if you bow to him. You will not be able to keep any of your programs if you don't go down there and get chipped. Mark what I'm telling you right now. A lot of you, compromised strictly to have a job when it came to what was going on with the pandemic. A lot of you broke to do that. So I know if they tell you, listen, you out there in the street and your Section 8 and your food stamps and all that is cut off and you can't get disability and you can't get your retirement either. If you broke under that, we know what you're going to do when it comes that come to the mark of the beast. Read.
Him shall be preached in all the world.
And that's what's going on right now, folks. Whether you believe it or not, the gospel, everything we're teaching right now is being taught everywhere. On earth, right now. Everywhere. People being baptized everywhere, right now. This gospel of the kingdom, the truth concerning Christ's kingdom, his people, and the kingdom to come is being taught through this church. And it doesn't matter what you feel about me. It doesn't matter. You can feel any way you want about me. That's good. I clear left. Okay. I know that what the Most High is doing through this church has awakened many to follow righteousness and God. And have led brothers and sisters to repentance for Christ's kingdom. And you know what? That's good enough. One thing no one can say, that when I was called to do a work, that I did what? That I turned away from it. No one can say that when the hard times came, that I packed up and rolled. Okay? No one can say that. I'm here. Anything I was called to do in this work is getting done. See? And that's what it's about. Even Paul says, show me your faith and I'll show you my faith by my works. He also talks about vain talkers. People who are just professional talkers with no works to show for anything. This gospel shall be preached throughout the four corners of the earth. Then what? The end shall come. Read.
Verse 15. When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet.
What is the abomination of a desolation, folks? The destiny for abomination. When you shall see armies, the cities overran by armies. That's the sign. All the roads in the United States and throughout the world are getting what? Repaved for tanks to roll on them. That's the sign. Folks, when the armies were there initially in Jerusalem, there was no war. It was no war. They were more so acting more so like police and all that. But that was a sign. They were actually strategically putting the Romans in place so when the order comes from Caesar, they'll already be there to fall on our feet. So initially, the armies and all that's going to be there outright as an accepted part of the population like it was in Jerusalem. You notice when the riots happen, here's one sign, the test run, doing the so-called George Floyd and all that other stuff and garbage politically they were doing out there during the election. You notice how they strategically in certain cities had military to protect the businesses in our neighborhoods. They weren't harming anyone. They wasn't shooting anyone. They were just showing a presence. Don't tell me the Bible isn't real, folks. So some of us Christians out there don't know this sign that Christ is talking about. Or you believe you're going to be raptured out of it.
Drink some pop.
No, you won't be.
Smoke some weed.
The desolation of abomination is when Rome stationed military, their army, within Jerusalem. And guess what? It was just to keep the peace initially until the order changed. Just like in Chicago, they're calling for help against the crime, and they're calling for the president to use the National Guard. And it's not other people crying for them. It's our people. So they're coming in to do something good. Show a presence to stop the crime until the order changes. See? You have to understand how politics run congruent with prophecy.
not anymore. Additionally, the governor
is getting us used to something that's unlawful. There's a law in the Constitution called posse comitatus, which forbids a standing army or an army that was assembled to protect the country to come into the country against its own citizenry. Posse comitatus. You're not supposed to have army inside the cities. So what did we see during the George Floyd thing? A test run of what? Crisis prophecy. The desolation of abomination. So when we see them on the corner, not just for a riot or for an instance, but they're there permanently, that's the sign. You'll still be able to travel and all that. But when they're there permanent, know that you only have up until the time the order changes. Come on.
Then let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains.
And then it's going to be time to get out of the system. The new security. Take whatever you got, turn into something tangible in a place that will still be in existence upon the coming of our Christ. That's when it's time to not be in some of these Western world countries. Above all, you cannot be in the city. At that time, when you see armies there, you have to start making way to be on the outside of all cities.
Very notable, there's a lot of white people out here in solidarity.
Read.
Let him which is on the housetop not come down to take anything out of his house.
Come on.
Neither let him which is in the field return back to take his clothes. And woe unto them that are with child and to them that give suck in those days.
Woe to them that give child, that have newborns in these days. And I'm going to say this. I'm going to just say this real quick in passing. Just a side note. If you're having children in this society, anywhere on earth, you better keep your child, your baby, next to you at all times. Don't allow anyone to say you're tired, you're going to need some rest. We'll look out for the baby. Let me take the baby into the other room with the other children. We'll look out. Listen, you're responsible for your child. If you're having a baby in one of these institutions, you better have that baby next to you 24 hours with shifts, looking out for you if you're sleeping with your family, with your husband, next of kin, family. If you're sleeping, somebody else better be there that you can trust to watch that baby. Same thing when it comes to family members. And guess what? And we're putting this out amongst all the churches. If we have someone, a member of our church, in the hospital, they are to be looked over and protected with support by the bedside 24/7, even if it's through shifts. Until that person or that baby walk out of that hospital. We are to be protected and looked upon if we are part of this church 24 hours until that person is what? You got it. Discharged out of the hospital. And that's the right word for it. Straight up. It's our responsibility to protect the ones we love. If there's a baby being born, that baby must be watched in the presence of his parents and those they love until that baby is released with his parents. The same with any other individual that's in our church. If you're in the hospital, you must have someone there 24 hours, even if it's on shifts. Let's go.
Yes, sir. Verse 20. But pray ye that your flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day. For then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. And except those days should be shortened.
And except Christ shortened these days,
there should no flesh be saved.
None of us would make it. None of us should make it, folks. They're planning to depopulate the earth to stave off the prophecy of our people coming together, gaining the power that was lost through our forefathers' disobedience. It's our time coming. And the New World Order is strategically working with dark forces to keep us from gaining the promise. This is a satanic war against the children of Christ. The children who would believe under Christ, who believe in this book. Read.
Verse number 23. Then if any man shall say unto you, lo, here is Christ, or there, believe it not.
If someone tell you that Christ already came, or he's in this area and he's in that area, don't believe him. Because when Christ returns, every eye shall see. The whole universe will be in dense darkness. And then the light. Every eye will know Christ's return. Every eye shall see. Dense darkness, and it tell you there's no light in it. You're not going to be able to even see your hand in front of your face. It's going to be that dark. The whole universe get dark, and then he becomes the light. So if anyone tell you, hey man, Christ is going to be here, Christ is going to be there, do not believe them. Read.
For there shall arise false Christ and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, and so much that if it were possible, they would deceive, or they shall deceive, the very elect.
If it was possible, they would deceive the very elect. So it's not possible to deceive the very elect, because we know what to look for. False prophets will come and say you'll be raptured out of this people before some boogeyman called the Antichrist pop up and say he's God. That's stupidity.
No justice! Peace! Peaceful protesting in this horrible locust in London.
God help us.
To those who want to turn this into something.
It happened so suddenly. This man came to power and ordered everyone to have his mark. The mark of the beast. 6 months ago, I snagged an exclusive interview with the Antichrist. Yes, the Antichrist. It is estimated that over 2 billion people are watching this broadcast around the globe.
Those are false prophets who came up with that false ideology. Read.
Verse 27. For as the lightning cometh out of the east and shineth even unto the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be.
That's how we'll see him. It's going to be total darkness, and you're going to see a light coming from the east into the earth. And the whole, every eye living shall see, and hell shall quake. The earth will open with an earthquake. The dead in Christ shall rise first and meet him here to judge the earth. And guess what? The first judgment will start, that's right, in Europe. Christ is coming to take Rome. First, and I can prove that. King James, his Aunt Elizabeth, his son, Charles, they will all be avenged by Christ. They'll all be avenged. Read.
Verse number 28. For wheresoever the carcass is, there will the eagles be gathered together. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light.
Come on.
And the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heaven shall be shaken. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn.
All the people shall mourn. Those who are united under the New World Order will mourn. No more will there be a Chinese diplomat or kingdom, a European diplomat or kingdom, a Middle Eastern diplomats or alliances or kingdoms against us. All of the people, I thought you were waiting for Christ. What are you crying for? I thought you was waiting on the day of the Lord. Why are all the people mourning? Because you haven't been following Christ. You don't know him. That's why they're crying. Because eventually they'll understand, like Moses, Christ has come to free the slaves and appoint them their rightful position on earth as kings. They're going to mourn. And then after that, those who is willing to do what's right will go into servitude under the children of Israel according to the Bible. Righteous servitude, not no slavery. Not no chattel evil slavery. Christ is just, but they will serve. Read.
And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When his branch is yet tender and putteth forth her leaves, ye know that summer is nigh.
So you know when summer is nigh, right? You start to see the leaves changing and all that. Usually you can look at nature and know that a new season is transitioning into existence. Okay. Read.
33. So likewise ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the door.
When you shall see all these things, know it's near. Christ's season is near. Know that it's at the door when you shall see all the signs mentioned. And again, Christians, walk away from the pagan church. They're lying to you. You will not be raptured. That's a lie. That's a false teaching from the Jesuits. There is no one Antichrist that's going to pop up and say, I am God, get the mark of the beast. That doesn't exist. It's fiction. Read.
Verse 34. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled.
What generation? The generation between Christ's birth and Christ is coming. It's talking about what? The last 3.5 years of time. Time in a dividing of times is that generation of time. The last days. It shall not pass until when?
Until all these things be fulfilled.
Until all things be fulfilled. With that, we're going to say shalom. Brothers and sisters, we will see you tomorrow in the Hebrew and Bible Academy. Breaking down. That's right. Who is the synagogue of Satan? I got a lot of information for you all. We got morals and dogma. We also have the learned elders of Zion. And I got some more records here. The Talmud unmasked, unabridged version. Who is Christ warning us about? Who's really running things in this earth? Huh? Well, you'll know that and more in our installment, week 8, right, Elder Lawyer?
Yes, sir.
Of the Hebrew and Bible Academy, week 8. I hope to see you there. But don't worry about it. I know a lot of you saying, well, hold up, it's week 8. Well, in a month from now, we'll have a brand new Hebrew and Bible Academy. And I want to break numbers. I want to make sure everyone is in this academy that's coming after this. Newfound information, research. So don't worry about it if you're not in for this one. Guess what? I want everyone, even if you have to get someone else to come in with you. We want to show the enemy that what? We value what the gathering of Christ Church through the Most High have been delivering on this earth with the support, not just here, but the Hebrew and Bible Academy. Okay, so go to historytimes.org, enroll for us. And let's start getting you in early so that you're not running in the last moment. And a lot of these records, oh, guess what? Woo! I don't know if I can say this one. A sister found a... you know, I gotta say it anyway. A sister found a Bible and gave it to Bishop Anya in Ohio. You know how sometimes you in these bookstores you find these rare information? Well, this particular book was a Bible that came out of one of the high Masonic temples. And they're dropping some stuff. Now, the King James Version Bible is intact. But what's some of the information before it is going to blow you away. That's all I can say on that right now. But keep your ear to the ground, and we're going to study this book, go through it, and reveal everything. So don't worry about it. But I got the information this morning. He texted me and showed me a few pages, and I'm like, you know what? This particular book in particular, I was looking for. You put that together with that Masonic encyclopedia. And I'm talking about from like the 1800s. They reveal everything, folks. I wish I had it for this academy identifying the synagogue of Satan, but don't worry about it. I'll have a synagogue of Satan lesson for the next academy too. And hopefully I'll have a lot of those records I can show publicly. All right. So get in the academy. HistoryTimes.org. I hope you've been enlightened here. I hope you understand the importance of gathering together before the doors close, literally. And reach out to us. If you need to reach out to know how to actually become a part of this work through the Spirit of Christ, go to Gathering as One. Take an email, GatheringAsOne@AOL.com. Reach out to us. We'll have someone in your respective areas connect with you for baptism so that we can all be together before the doors close. Thank you throughout the four corners of the earth. I'm Elder Ricarcio with Elder Lawyer signing off. I'll see my brothers over there on the other side of the pond very soon. I'll see you all. With that, may the Most High be with you. Stay prayed up. Sin not. We will soon see Zion. And yes, now I hope you understand the insane world Christ warned us about. Shalom.
Shalom.
Smoting his arms, the man child, the cedar of Lebanon, selling out arenas. King James, check the regal features. Hebrew beard, brown skin like Jesus. King James, the book the elite don't want you to read. It speaks of a promised seed that left Egypt. The wine is the blood of Christ, the gold is the crown. And if we spiritually condition, we will never put down. Wine and gold, the colors of the Bible. The Most High sending the signs because these times getting vital. The kingdom is the golden state. The priest wore white, blue, purple, and gold, froze like number 8. Blood of a saint, heart of a king. Lions of Judah during the dark ages. King James was a ruler. Black stewards, families in England today related to the black Moors that was kicked out of Spain. 1492, Catholics try to whitewash our pagans, try to assassinate King James. Tyreek took Spain in 711. After September Severus took Rome, black emperors, this is why they fear us, that lion blood in you. That's why they hear your heritage profile you as menaces, put iron up in you, Zion's up in you. They put all these lies up in you so you wouldn't find truth if you meant to. Thank the Knights, Templars, and Masons. They know James means Jacob. They enslaved and colonized the holy nation. Gird up the loins in your mind. Most devoted, martyred, and died. In all the woes of time, the strongest was tried. It don't end good on this side, but on the other side, we live. Receive abundantly, all with the pride. Try to fuse a Christ and Maccabee's mind to make these Catholic priests resign. The great I am is a higher calling this vine.
Hello.
Who can find a virtuous woman? For her prices fall above rubies. The heart of a husband doth safely trust in her, so that he shall have no need of spoil. She will do him good and not evil all the days of her life.
Call me Judith. Call me Sarah. Call me Leah. Call me Esther. Call me Deborah. 'Cause an Israelite woman ain't like no other. We obey our lords, manage our homes, and still make time for loving. Call me Judith. Call me Sarah. Call me Leah. Call me Esther. Call me Deborah. 'Cause an Israelite woman ain't like no other. We obey our lords, manage our homes, and still make time for loving. Hold up, we're coming up. Righteous woman, covered up. We honest, stay modest. We persevere for the promise. Put it in work, helping our brothers and helping the church. Put it in work, helping our sisters come out of the dirt. The other nations, they trying to do what we do. The devils take us, we're the children of the book. The other nations, they trying to do what we do. Black is beautiful and they know that's not true. Oh, call me Judith,
Judith.
Oh, call me Sarah,
Sarah.
Call me Leah, call me Esther, call me Deborah. 'Cause an Israelite woman ain't like no other. We obey our lords, manage our homes, and still make time for loving. Call me Judith,
Judith.
Call me Sarah,
Sarah.
Call me Leah, call me Esther, call me Deborah. 'Cause an Israelite woman ain't like no other. We obey our lords, manage our homes, and still make time for loving. Give us our Israelite man. Israelite man. Give us our Israelite man. Give us our Israelite man.
Royal kings of the earth, holy priests of the church,
teaching us the laws.
The prophets are back and the righteous be heard.
The other nations, they tryna do what we do. The devils take us, we're the children of the book. The other nations, they tryna do what we do. Black is beautiful and they know that's not true. Oh, call me Judith,
Judith.
Oh, call me Sarah,
Sarah.
Call me Leah, call me Esther, call me Deborah. 'Cause an Israelite woman ain't like no other. We obey our lords, manage our homes, and still make time.
Behind me since it begun. My friends fell to the right, some to the left. Some won't even listen, they embrace death. Please bless the souls of those that's getting rest. And please take a hold so I won't fold to the flesh. It's a lonely road, only you know how far to go. So I put my soul under your control. Got my steps, I follow the glow where you direct. Endure, endure, push it out. Gotta get tried in the flame to make it pure. Don't ignore the alone, filling your head with doubt. Keep faith in the higher Christ, show the route. I ain't gonna complain about a thing, wait and pout. I'ma walk it out till I'm in my father's house.
This walk is so alone, don't have too far to go. Keep faith before you know, the Father will bring us home. This walk is so alone, don't have to. too far to go. Keep faith before you know. The Father will bring us home. Home. 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 The Father will bring us home.
We on third base, about to slide home. Hopefully we make it safe. A lot of brothers and sisters getting struck out all over the place. It's my time to bat, I gotta hit a home run. All bases are loaded, the game is almost done. We winning and we gon' make it, cause we got faith. The other team losing, cause their game plan is hate. Christ is our head coach and I ain't talking cranium. All praises to the Father, he's the owner of the stadium. And we the home team. I got love for all my brothers and sisters. It don't matter if you don't know me. We gotta listen to the coach if we wanna go home. Too many falls gon' have you missing teachers like a cone. Make sure you waking up early and give the Father praise. And thank him for health and the chance to play another day. Put in the work and tell the Father say retire. He gonna bring us home and keep us out the fire. Yes.
This walk is so alone. Don't have too far to go. Keep faith before you know. The Father will bring us home. This walk is so alone. Don't have too far to go. Keep faith before you know. The Father will bring us home. Home. 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 The Father will bring us home.
Mm-hmm.